Hello everyone. Now today we will be starting with chronic heart failure. Chronic heart failure is also known as congestive heart failure. Now what is the definition of chronic heart failure? Chronic heart failure means there is some damage to the heart. Because of this reason, the heart is unable to pump the blood as per the requirement of the organs. Okay? The requirement of the organs for the blood is something. The heart is unable to pump the blood as per the requirement of the organ. This is known as chronic heart failure. Okay. Now, there is some damage to the heart. We know that heart pumps the blood. The blood which is pumped by the heart is known as cardiac output. Okay. The blood which is pumped by the heart is cardiac output. And suppose these are the peripheral organs, let's say brain. In heart failure, the cardiac output becomes less. Because of this reason, the requirement of the organs are not met. Now, what happens further? Let's understand this part. Let's talk about the pathology. When there is some damage to the heart, the most common cause of damage which leads to chronic heart failure is MI, myocardial infarction. What happens when the heart is unable to pump the blood? These organs discharge certain compensatory mechanism. Okay, they start certain compensatory mechanisms or neurohormonal mechanism. These compensatory and neurohormonal mechanisms, they will try to increase the cardiac output. Okay, so they will try to increase the cardiac output so that the heart will be able to pump the sufficient amount of blood. Now, what are these neurohormonal mechanisms? The heart, how they will increase cardiac output? These compensatory mechanisms, they will increase cardiac output by this compensatory mechanism is that is the discharge of sympathetic nervous system. Okay, so this brain will tell to the heart to pump more blood, so it will give sympathetic discharge. Okay, so when there is fallen cardiac output, some compensatory mechanism start. That compensatory mechanism is sympathetic output. Now, what this sympathetic discharge will do? So this sympathetic discharge, it will go to the heart. On heart, there is beta 1 receptor. Okay, it will go to the heart, and on heart there is beta 1 receptor of sympathetic nervous system, and this beta 1 stimulates heart. It will stimulate heart and it will try to increase cardiac output. Okay, now the point is, when the heart is continuously beating more because of stimulation by sympathetic nervous system, what will happen to the muscles of the heart? The muscles of the heart will become hypertrophied, so it leads to cardiac hypertrophy. Okay, it leads to cardiac muscle hypertrophy, which is also known as cardiac remodeling. Now, this cardiac remodeling is a very dangerous condition for the heart, because the hypertrophied muscles, they will have more oxygen and nutritional requirement, and already the patient has suffered from myocardial infarction MI. So this heart, hypertrophied heart, is a very bad heart. Okay, why? Because the demand of this heart will be even more. Now, second, so this was upon heart. The second point is, this beta 1 receptor, they are also present on kidney. They are also present on kidney. And when beta 1 stimulation occurs on kidney, this kidney release renin. This kidney release renin, and renin will start one system known as renin angiotensin aldosterone system. Okay, aldosterone system. Okay, now what is the function of this aldosterone system? That I will discuss you tell you later on. The third point is blood vessels. The third point is blood vessels. Remember, there will be venoconstriction. The veins of the body will constrict so that more amount of blood should reach into the heart, so that more amount of the blood should come into the heart. So this is known as increase in preload. Increase in preload. Second point, there is also arterial constriction. Arterial constriction occurs in non-vital organs, like mainly skin, GIT, so that this heart, this brain will say that please divert all of the blood towards me. Okay, that is why arterial constriction occurs. This is known as increase in afterload. Because of this reason, heart has to pump a blood towards higher pressure. Okay, now what is the function of this RAS system? This RAS system increases blood volume or blood pressure. Okay, and increase in blood volume and blood pressure also contribute to these two things. Okay, it will put more pressure on the heart and it will lead to more cardiac hypertrophy, and it will also increase the pressure on veins and arteries, which will increase the preload and afterload. Okay, so because of this reason, the cardiac output will increase. So it's a good thing for the brain, but the point is, these three neurohormonal mechanisms, they will put more pressure on the heart. These things will put more pressure on the heart. More pressure on heart. Because of this reason, for some time the cardiac output will be maintained, but at the last, this will further reduce cardiac output. It will further reduce cardiac output because the heart is already been damaged and you are putting more pressure on the heart. So it will further reduce cardiac output. Okay, so this is a vicious cycle, and hence chronic heart failure is a progressive disease. Okay, so this neurohormonal mechanism, cardiac hypertrophy, renin angiotensin aldosterone system, and increase in preload is a vicious cycle. It will put more pressure on the heart and the heart will fail more easily. So let's see what are the different stages of heart failure. Okay, let's see what are the different stages of heart failure. And according to stages, we have treatment. Stages of heart failure. Okay, now there is a classification. That classification is known as NYHA classification. NYHA stands for New York Heart Association, and this association has given the staging of heart failure. Okay, New York Heart Association. According to NYHA, there are four stages of heart failure. There are four stages of heart failure: stage A, stage B, stage C, and stage D. Okay. Now, how this NYHA criteria has divided heart failure into four stages? Sir, on the basis of one test known as echocardiography. There's a test known as echocardiography. On this echocardiography, we can easily measure whether there is any structural damage to the heart or not. Is there any damage on the heart or not? And we can easily measure the cardiac output also. Okay. And second point we will be asking from the patient is about the symptoms. Okay. Second thing we will be asking about the patient is symptom. So we will see the damage on the heart and we will ask the symptoms. Now, in stage A, the heart is absolutely normal and there are no symptoms. The heart is absolutely normal and there are no symptoms. Then why we are classifying this stage A into heart failure? Because the risk factors are present. The risk factors are present which can lead to heart failure. Now, what are the different risk factors which lead to heart failure? Like MI, hypertension, diabetes, etc. Okay, the most common cause risk factor is MI. Now, what is the treatment of this stage? The main treatment of this stage is lifestyle modification. Okay. That tell the patient to quit smoking, take a good diet, and similarly low atherogenic diet which can lead to MI, that we will discuss in MI. Now, the drug of choice in stage A heart failure is ACE inhibitors. Okay, or ARB. ARB stands for angiotensin 1 receptor blocker. Okay. So the drug of choice for stage A is ACE inhibitors or ARB. Okay, even if the risk factors are present, we give, because they can prevent the occurrence of heart failure. Okay, now what is stage B? In stage B, the heart is damaged. That means there is cardiac remodeling. Okay? And still there are no symptoms. Still there are no symptoms. Okay? If there is no symptom and heart is damaged, then we sometimes classify it as NYHA-A. NYHA-1. 1 means 1, 2, 3 and 4 are on the basis of symptoms. Okay? So NYHA stage 1. No symptoms with heart damage. Now what is the treatment? If there is evidence of heart damage, the drug of choice, we continue with ACE inhibitor or ARB. And we add beta blockers. We add beta blockers. Because I will tell you that this ACE inhibitor, ARB and beta blocker, they inhibit cardiac remodeling. They inhibit cardiac remodeling. Okay? So, let's move further. Let's come to stage C. In stage C, the heart is again damaged. And there are symptoms. Okay, there are symptoms. We ask the patient that after doing how much activity the symptoms of heart failure appears. If it is mild symptoms, if the symptoms are mild, a person says after doing a lot of strenuous exercise, then I feel tired. Or if there is marked symptoms, marked symptoms is after doing a little bit exercise, I feel tired. Okay, so these are known as NYHA 2 and 3. NYHA 2 and 3 stage. Okay, now in this stage, we have to do two things. We have to control the heart damage and we have to control the symptoms. Remember, the heart damage is controlled by the drugs which can inhibit cardiac remodeling. Okay, so we have to give two things. We have to prevent heart damage or prevent remodeling. Okay, and we have to control symptoms as well. Now, what are the drugs which can prevent cardiac remodeling? It's very simple. As we have seen the pathology, if we come back to this normal, we know that this cardiac hypertrophy, it started with the beta 1 receptor, and then there is a RAS system, and these vasodilators are also contributing. So can we say if we will inhibit this beta receptor, beta blocker, they will also inhibit stimulation of heart and they will inhibit cardiac hypertrophy? Similarly, if we inhibit RAS system, it also contribute to prevent cardiac remodeling, and we give vasodilators. So these are the drugs which will dilate, which will decrease preload and afterload. Okay, so these are the drugs which will inhibit cardiac remodeling, which will decrease the pressure on the heart. So we will write the mnemonic, which are the drugs which generally inhibit cardiac remodeling. You'll write the mnemonic Sahib. Okay, the first drug is sacubitril. It's a new drug recently been approved. Then the drug which inhibit RAS system, that is ACE inhibitor or ARB. Okay, ACE inhibitor or ARB. Similarly, so they will inhibit conversion of synthesis of angiotensin. Then the aldosterone which has been formed, so they will inhibit ACE inhibitor and ARB. They will inhibit angiotensin. Then we have aldosterone blocker. We have aldosterone antagonist. Okay, then we have a combination of vasodilator hydralazine with isosorbide dinitrate. Isosorbide dinitrate. Okay, what is that? We will discuss that this hydralazine will be an arterial dilator. It will be an artery dilator. It will hydralazine, artery dilator. Isosorbide dinitrate will be a venodilator. So they will decrease afterload and preload. Then we have a new drug, evabradine, which we have discussed in angina also. Evabradine directly suppresses heart. And lastly, we have beta blockers. So these are the drugs which inhibit cardiac remodeling. So we will be coming to these drugs shortly. Okay. Now, to control the symptoms, To control the symptoms, first we have to assess what type of heart failure it is, what type of symptoms it is. To control the symptoms, remember, most of the heart failure is generally heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. Ejection fraction is also known as cardiac output. Cardiac output we measure on echocardiography by ejection fraction, or heart failure with preserved ejection fraction or cardiac output. Okay, it is also sometimes known as forward failure. Means the heart is unable to do systole. The heart is unable to contract. That is why the blood is not moving forward. Heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, it is also known as backward failure. Backward failure means the heart is unable to relax. Okay, the heart is unable to relax. The heart is unable to do diastole. On this basis, there are different treatment options. If there is no systole, the heart is unable to pump the blood, then we will give a drug that will go and directly stimulate the heart. The drug of choice, if there is reduced ejection fraction, the cardiac output is reduced, the drug of choice is digoxin. And with digoxin, you will write, digoxin is an oral inotrope. Inotrope means a drug that will directly go on the heart and stimulate that heart. Okay, and it is the only inotrope which is approved in heart failure, chronic heart failure. Rest all other inotrope are injectable drug that I will tell you they are used in acute heart failure, not in chronic heart failure. Okay, and sometimes we add artery dilators. Sometimes we add artery dilators like hydralazine. Okay, so that the heart can easily pump the blood forward. Now what about backward failure? In backward failure, can we say the heart is unable to relax? Because of this reason, all the blood will be collected in veins. Okay, all the blood will be collected in veins, and because of this reason, the patient suffers from congestion. Hence we give a drug, diuretic, to remove this extra amount of blood outside the body through urine. And we give venodilators. Which venodilator? You can write nitrates. Okay, and sometimes we give a combined dilator also, that is nitroprusside, if both symptoms are there, then we prefer to give nitroprusside also, because nitroprusside is both an artery as well as a venodilator. It's a combined dilator. Okay, so this is the treatment of stage C. Now what about stage D? Stage D is also known as refractive heart failure. It is also known as refractory heart failure. That means when you have given these inotropic agents and diuretics to control the symptom, still the symptoms are not controlled, then we say the patient is in refractory heart failure. In refractory heart failure, the patient is bedridden. The symptoms are even at rest. It is also known as NYHA stage 4. So it is also known as NYHA stage 4. Okay. Now, what is the treatment? So we continue this whole treatment. We continue this treatment of stage C. Okay. And we give chronic inotrope on long term basis, that is digoxin. Okay, we give chronic diuretics, same treatment. Okay, chronic diuretic. Sometimes we add one vasodilator or diuretic, that is natriuretic peptides. So this is an additional point you must remember. In stage 4, sometimes we add natriuretic peptide, while rest of the treatment is same like stage 3. Now the point is, in stage 4, the patient is having symptoms at rest because the heart is severely damaged. The definitive treatment of stage 4 is heart transplant. Because now this heart is now permanently damaged, the definitive treatment of stage D Stage D is heart transplant. Okay, so this is an indication of doing heart transplant. So this you must remember. Okay, so stage D, the treatment is heart transplant. Now let's discuss what are the drugs we have for this chronic heart failure. This is what we have discussed, how to manage. Now let's discuss pharmacology. Let's discuss about drugs for chronic heart failure. Okay, okay, now the drugs for chronic heart failure, they are divided into four. There are four treatment goals we have to give. The first point, sir, we have to give the drug which will inhibit cardiac remodeling, which will inhibit cardiac remodeling or cardiac hypertrophy. And these are the drugs, they are protective for heart. These are the drugs, they are protective for heart. And on long term, these drugs can reduce mortality. These drugs can reduce mortality. It can prolong the life of a person. Okay. Now, what are the other drugs? Other three drugs, they are generally given to control symptoms. They are generally given to control symptoms. And first we will write the drugs. The first drug we will write will be given to reduce preload. Okay, preload or venodilator. Second, we will write the drug which are given to reduce afterload or artery dilator. And lastly, we give inotropic drugs. And the only inotropic drug which is approved in chronic heart failure, the only drug which is approved is oral digoxin. There is no other inotropic drug which is approved in chronic heart failure. Because of this reason, this drug digoxin becomes very important for you, and you have to remember each and every detail of this drug. Okay, digoxin. Now the point is, sir, all these drugs, they cannot reduce long-term mortality. They cannot reduce mortality of a patient on long term. They are just to control symptoms. Okay. So which drug can prolong the life of a person by protecting the heart? The drug which inhibit cardiac remodeling. So digoxin, it cannot reduce long term mortality benefit. It is not protective for the heart. We are rather stimulating the heart by digoxin. Okay. So let's see, discuss each of these four drugs one by one. So let's discuss first about the drugs which inhibit cardiac remodeling. We have already written a mnemonic. The drug which inhibit cardiac remodeling was Sahib. Okay, we have already written the drug Sahib. Okay, now the first drug is sacubitril. The first drug is sacubitril. There is a new drug like sacubitril which is in clinical trial. You can write that name, Icadrotel. It is under clinical trial. Very soon it will get approved. So let's discuss first about this sacubitril. Okay. Now what is this sacubitril? You will write, sacubitril is a neutral endo peptidase inhibitor. Neutral endopeptidase inhibitor, which is sometimes known as NEP enzyme. NEP stand for neutral endopeptidase. This enzyme is also known as neprilysin enzyme. Okay. So it is a NEP inhibitor or neprilysin inhibitor. Now this enzyme is responsible for degradation of natriuretic peptides. This enzyme is responsible for degradation of natriuretic peptide, and you have inhibited this enzyme by sacubitril. Hence, this sacubitril, it is mechanism of action is it increases the level of natriuretic peptides in our body. okay, increases the level of natriuretic peptides in the body, and these natriuretic peptides, they decrease preload and afterload. Because of this reason, the pressure on the heart will decrease, and slowly cardiac size or cardiac hypertrophy decreases. Okay, now this is an approved drug, sacubitril. How we give sacubitril? Sacubitril we give in combination with a drug that is known as valsartan. What is valsartan? It is an ARB, angiotensin 1 receptor blocker. We give sacubitril in combination with valsartan. Okay, so remember this point. Now there is a similar drug which will soon get approved, that is Icadrotil. Icadrotil. There is one more drug, that is Omapetrilat. So these drugs are right now not approved. Okay. Sacubitril is an approved drug. Okay. Now Omapetrilat. So this Icadrotil is an NEP inhibitor. You don't have to remember its name. You have to remember this name, Omapetrilat. You will write, Omapetrilat is NEP inhibitor. It has also a property of ACE inhibitor. It is a combined NEP inhibitor and ACE inhibitor. Okay. ACE stands for angiotensin 1 convertase enzyme. Okay. So this is the first drug, sacubitril. Second drug you will write is ACE inhibitor or ARB. They can be used interchangeably. All ACE inhibitor, they will end with the word pril, like enalapril, lisinopril, captopril, etc. Most commonly we use enalapril and lisinopril. Okay. And ARB stands for angiotensin 1 receptor blocker. These drugs, they end with the word sartan. Most commonly we use candesartan. But there are other drugs which you can use, like olmesartan, etc. So all of these drugs, they end with the word sil. So you can use all ACE inhibitor or ARB. Now, what is the important point? ACE inhibitor and ARB, they are the drug of choice for chronic heart failure. Why? Because they are the first drug to be started. They are first drug to be started. Okay, remember. So how we start? If the patient of heart failure comes, we first start ACE inhibitor. If the patient cannot tolerate ACE inhibitor, we can start ARB. The second drug we generally add is beta blocker. This is the second drug we add. Okay, then we generally add aldosterone antagonist, and then we add other drugs which we have written. This is how we add. Okay, then we add other drugs. In this way we go. So first drug which is always started is ACE inhibitor or ARB. The second drug which we add is beta blocker. Third we add is aldosterone antagonist. Then rest of the other drug we add. Okay, then we have is aldosterone antagonist. Aldosterone antagonist, there are two drugs which are approved. You will like spironolactone and eplirenone. So these are the drugs which are approved. Then we have a combination of hydralazine and isosorbide dinitrate. Okay, this hydralazine is an artery dilator. It dilates artery. And nitrate, they are venodilator. They dilate veins. Can we say then this combination will dilate both artery and vein? This combination is also known as bidyl. This combination is also known as bidyl. Bi means both, dil means dilator. Okay, then we have a new drug which has been approved in angina also and heart failure also, evabradine. Evabradine is given as an add-on drug. Okay, now evabradine, bradine word coming, bradine means it causes bradycardia. What is the effect of evabradine? Bradycardia means it decreases heart rate. Okay, how it decreases heart rate? By inhibiting funny channels on SA node by inhibiting funny channels on SA node. Okay, so this drug we have already discussed in great detail in angina also. So refer this drug when you will see the videos of angina. Okay, and lastly we have a drug that is beta blockers. Okay, beta blockers. Now the point is, beta blockers, there are only three beta blockers which are approved in heart failure. There are only three beta blockers which are approved. The first beta blocker which is an approved in heart failure which can inhibit cardiac remodeling is carvedilol. Okay, carvedilol. And you will write carvedilol is a non-selective beta blocker. Okay, plus it also blocks alpha 1 and calcium channel blocking property. Okay, so just refer carvedilol in beta blocker part. Second we will write is bisoprolol. Bisoprolol is a cardioselective beta blocker. And lastly, metoprolol succinate. Metoprolol succinate. There is one salt of metoprolol known as metoprolol tartarate. No, only these three beta blockers are approved in cardiac, in heart failure, and these beta blocker, they can prevent cardiac remodeling. Now the point is, we will write certain points with this beta blocker. My question from you people is, sir, what will happen to the cardiac output when we give beta blockers? What will happen to the cardiac output when we give beta blocker? So beta blocker, they generally reduce cardiac output by inhibiting beta 1 receptor. So what do you like to think that we should give this beta blocker in heart failure? So earlier we used to believe that we should not give beta blocker in heart failure because they will further reduce cardiac output. But now it has been proven if we use this beta blocker in low dose beta blocker, they do not reduce cardiac output. Okay, and they can be safely given in heart failure. So we give this beta blocker in low dose, they do not suppress cardiac output. Okay, and we will write next point. These beta blocker, among all drugs, they cause maximum inhibition of cardiac remodeling. So cardiac remodeling is maximum inhibited by beta blockers. They inhibit cardiac remodeling up to 35%. Okay, ACE inhibitor, they inhibit cardiac remodeling around 20%. So maximum inhibition of cardiac remodeling is by beta blocker. That means they have maximum beneficial effect in case of heart failure. Okay, and only these three beta blockers are approved. Okay, you have to remember their name, three beta blockers. Okay, so they should be started with low dose. They should be given in low dose, and only three beta blockers are approved. Now sir, remember one point. These beta blocker, they are absolutely contraindicated if the cardiac output is critically narrow or critically low. They are absolutely contraindicated in decompensated heart failure. Decompensated heart failure or stage D heart failure, because in stage D heart failure the cardiac output is critically narrow, so they are absolutely contraindicated in decompensated heart failure. Okay, they are also absolutely contraindicated in acute heart failure. Okay, we will be discussing about acute heart failure after this chapter. And remember, the first beta blocker which we developed was propranolol. Propranolol is absolutely contraindicated. Only three beta blockers are approved. Just try to remember, this question is asked. Propranolol is absolutely contraindicated. Okay, propranolol causes vasoconstriction, which may increase the cardiac output, which may increase the afterload. Propranolol is a vasoconstrictor. It may increase the afterload. Hence, we never give propranolol only 3 beta blockers are approved. So this is a very important point. So role of beta blocker in heart failure. Okay, we start with low dose and they have maximum beneficial effect. Okay, so this is about the drugs which inhibit cardiac remodeling. There are certain drugs which can be given, but we will write there are certain drugs which do not inhibit cardiac remodeling, but they were tried. They were tried in research. We tried these drugs in heart failure, but we have found that these drugs, they do not inhibit cardiac remodeling. These drugs are calcium channel blockers. Okay, now calcium channel blocker, remember they are of two type. One is non-DHP and second is DHP type. Among non-DHP, we have verapamil and diltiazam. Verapamil and diltiazam, they inhibit calcium channel. They block calcium channel mainly on heart. Okay, and these drugs, they decrease cardiac output. And these drugs, they have no effect on cardiac remodeling. Because of this reason, they are proven to be harmful in cases of heart failure. These two drugs, verapamil and diltiazam, they are absolutely contraindicated in heart failure. They are absolutely contraindicated in heart failure patient. We never give verapamil and diltiazam in heart failure. Okay. Now, what about DHP type? DHP type of calcium channel blockers like amlodipine, phelodipine, etc. So they also do not inhibit cardiac remodeling. But the point is where they act. So these verapamil and diltiazam mainly act on heart. These two drugs, they are generally act on artery. They are artery dilator. So these drugs, they can be used to decrease afterload. These drugs, they can be used to decrease the afterload in cases of heart failure. So these drugs can be given in heart failure, but to control the symptoms. Even these drugs, they do not inhibit cardiac remodeling. Verapamil and diltiazam, they are absolutely contraindicated because they act on heart, they decrease the cardiac output. Amlodipine and phelodipine also, they don't have any beneficial effect on cardiac remodeling, but yes, they can control the symptoms, they can decrease the afterload, so they can be used. Okay, but any calcium channel blocker will not inhibit cardiac remodeling. Okay, any calcium channel blocker will not inhibit cardiac remodeling. Okay, chaliye. And this is all about the drug which inhibit cardiac remodeling. Now let's talk about the drug to control symptoms. Okay, so the first symptom we have to decrease is decrease preload. Preload we give generally in cases if the patient has symptoms of congestion and pulmonary edema, then we decrease preload. Okay, because preload means the vein, it is bringing the blood to the heart. Okay, and from the right side of the heart it will go to the lungs, and from lungs it will go to the left side of the heart. From here artery comes. Now increase in preload means, suppose the left ventricle is not functioning. If the left ventricle is not functioning, can we say the blood will be collected in lungs? There will be pulmonary edema, and the blood will be collected in right heart and in veins. When the blood will be connected in veins, there will be congestion or edema in the whole body. Now, what is the drug of choice for edema? The drug of choice for decreasing preload to remove congestion and pulmonary edema in heart failure, the drug of choice is invariably loop diuretics. The drug of choice is loop diuretics. Examples you can write is furosemide, torsemide, bumetanide. So these are the drugs. Okay, sir, in resistant cases, if they cannot properly remove edema, sir, we add thiazides. We add thiazides. Okay. Now which thiazide? Either you can add oral metazolone. This is the most preferred drug. Or you can give IV chlorthalidone as an add-on drug to loop diuretics. Okay. While these loop diuretic, they can be given oral as well as IV, any route. So you just have to remember the name loop diuretic, thiazide diuretics. Okay. Now, even if the symptoms are not controlled, then we can also add potassium sparing diuretic, the third diuretic. Potassium sparing diuretic. These drugs are generally amiloride, triamterene. We can add them. Okay. Potassium sparing diuretic. Sir, if it is still not controlled, still there is edema and pulmonary congestion, then generally it occurs in cases of stage D. When it is not controlled by diuretic, we call them as refractory heart failure. We know that point. Then we can add natriuretic peptides. Then we can add natriuretic peptides. You just write the names of natriuretic peptides. This part we will be discussing in acute heart failure. You will write recombinant BNP. BNP stands for brain natriuretic peptide. We give nesiritide. And it is only and only given IV. Okay. You can give. So this is the only approved drug right now, nesiritide. But there are other new drugs which are in the market. ANP. Just write the word carperitide. And lastly, recombinant CNP. Sorry. Recombinant urodilantin. The drug name is ulariptide. So if the symptoms are not controlling, not able to control of congestion, then we add natriuretic peptide in stage D. In stage D, we add natriuretic peptides. So the drug which is an approved is nesiritide. Other two drugs, carperitide and ulariptide, they are right now not approved drug, but very soon they will get approved. Okay, ulariptide. Now let's talk about the drug that will reduce afterload. Okay, the drug that will reduce afterload. Okay, when there is increase in afterload, remember the patient suffers from systemic hypertension. Increase in afterload causes systemic hypertension. So in heart failure due to vasoconstriction in artery, there could be hypertension. The drug of choice to reduce this afterload is hydralazine. It's an artery dilator. But remember, we don't give hydralazine alone. We give hydralazine with isosorbide dinitrate. Okay? That is a venodilator. So we don't give, never give artery dilator alone. To reduce the afterload, we add a venodilator also. And we know this combination is known as Bidyl. And it is also inhibit cardiac remodeling. Okay. Now, sir, we have tried other drug which can decrease afterload or dilate arteries. But these drugs, they were not proven to be much effective. We have started tested alpha blockers like prazosin. We tested calcium channel blocker DHP type like amlodipine and phelodipine. But these drugs, they are now not used. They were used earlier, but nowadays they are not used. For dilate artery, we give just this combination. Okay. If there is systemic hypertension in case of heart failure. Okay. Okay. So sometimes in refractory cases, of hydralazine and isosorbide dinitrate, we give a drug nitroprusside. Which is a combined dilator. So if hydralazine and isosorbide dinitrate doesn't work, then we add nitroprusside. So this is how we control the symptoms. Now the last class of drug in chronic heart failure we have is that is inotropic drug, and this drug we will be discussing in great detail, and it's a very important drug for you. The only inotropic drug which is approved in CHF chronic heart failure, the only drug which has been approved is digoxin. No other inotropic drug is approved in chronic heart failure. Okay, now what do we mean by inotropic drug? Inotropic drug means that these drugs, they increase cardiac contractility. These drugs, they increase cardiac contractility. Because of this reason, there will be increase in force of contraction. There will be increase in force of contraction. Increase in force of contraction is known as inotropism, and that increases cardiac output. That increases cardiac output. Okay. So these drugs are used. Now, these inotropic drug overall, if we discuss overall inotropic drug, remember inotropic drugs, they are used in chronic heart failure. And they are also used in acute heart failure. It is also used in acute decompensated heart failure. In chronic heart failure, we have only one drug. The drug of choice is digoxin, which can be given orally as well as IV. So it's an oral inotrope, and it is the only oral inotrope we have. While in acute heart failure, we give IV drugs. These IV inotropes are other drugs. Okay, they are only IV inotrope we have. Okay, only IV inotropes. So in acute heart failure, we generally give intravenous drug. In chronic heart failure, there is only one drug approved, which is digoxin. So after chronic heart failure, we will be discussing about acute heart failure, and we will discuss their inotropes are little bit different. Okay, so let's right now focus on this digoxin. And this group of digoxin is known as cardiac glycosides. The group of this digoxin is known as cardiac glycosides. Okay, cardiac glycoside. Now what do we mean by the word glycoside? Cardiac means they will act on heart. Glycoside means it is a chemical structure. It is a chemical structure. The chemical structure of glycoside means it contains one sugar moiety and it contains one non-sugar moiety known as a glycone. The combination of a sugar and a glycone is known as cardiac glycoside. It is known as glycoside. Okay. Now these cardiac glycosides, where we obtain from, what is the source? These cardiac glycosides, they are obtained from digitalis plant. They are obtained from digitalis plant. This plant is also known as fox glove plant. It is also known as fox glove plant. Okay, now there are two species of digitalis plant. You will write, one is digitalis lineata, one is digitalis purpura. Okay, from digitalis lineata we obtain a drug which we have already written, digoxin, and digoxin is an approved drug. Okay, digitalis purpura we obtain a drug, digitoxin. Digitoxin is unfortunately not approved drug, but we will be discussing about what is the difference between digoxin and digitoxin. Okay, so remember this part. From digoxin is obtained from digitalis lineata. Okay, now these two drugs are commonly used. Among them, digoxin is commonly used, but there are other glycosides which are present in our nature. Let's see what are the other glycosides which are present in nature. There is one glycoside known as oebane. It is used as a poison by certain cultures, certain tribes, oebane. There is one more chemical which is also a cardiac glycoside, strophanthin. Okay, these two chemicals, they are obtained from a plant known as Strophanthus plant. Strophanthus plant we obtain. And you have to remember oebane word. Okay, third, you can write, there is one more cardiac glycoside known as bufotoxin. Bufotoxin is obtained from a bufo. Bufo is a species of a frog or a toad. Okay, it is obtained from bufo toad. Okay, saliva of bufo toad. Now, among them, we commonly use digitoxin. This is the most commonly used drug. Now, let's see how this cardiac glycosides, they increase cardiac output. What is their mechanism of action? Okay, so let's see what is the mechanism of action of this digoxin or cardiac glycoside. Let's make a heading. Digoxin or cardiac glycosides. Okay, mechanism of action. You will write that this digoxin or cardiac glycoside on heart, they are positive inotropic drug. Positive inotropic drug means they will increase force of contraction, hence they will increase cardiac output. But sir, these drugs on heart, they are negatively, that means they will suppress SA node. If SA node is suppressed, they decrease heart rate. This is known as they are negatively chronotropic. They are negatively chronotropic. They also inhibit SA node, AV node. Hence, they will decrease conduction. Decrease in conduction is also known as dromotropic. Okay? And their effect on SA node and AV node is a direct effect. They directly go to SA node and AV node and inhibit. Can you tell me some nerves which comes on the heart, and that nerve, that parasympathetic nerve on heart, also inhibit SA node and AV node? That nerve is known as vagus nerve. Vagus nerve also inhibit SA node and AV node. So that is why this effect of digoxin on SA node and AV node is known as direct vagomimetic effect. Direct vagomimetic effect. Okay? But the point is, if we talk about vagus nerve, remember vagus nerve is also negatively inotropic. Vagus nerve also decreases force of contraction. Remember, the inotropic effect of digoxin comes due to some other mechanism. The inotropic effect of digoxin comes because of some other reason. It comes because it inhibits one channel on heart. It inhibits sodium potassium ATPase channel on heart. It inhibits sodium potassium ATPase channel on heart, and this provides the positive inotropic effect of digoxin. So cardiac glycosides, they inhibit sodium potassium ATPase channel on heart. Because of this reason, they increase force of contraction. Okay, so let's see if we inhibit the sodium potassium ATPase channel, what is this channel and how it increases the force of contraction and how it increases the cardiac output. Let's understand this mechanism now. Okay, so suppose this is a heart cell. This is a heart cell. On this heart cell, what happens? There is one channel. The function of this channel is to remove sodium out of the cell and bring back potassium into the cell. Because normally potassium is present inside the cell, sodium is present outside the cell. So it is inside the cell, it is in blood, outside blood. Okay, blood. So the function of this channel is to throw back sodium outside and bring back potassium inside, and this channel will not do the work in free, it requires ATP. So it is known as sodium potassium ATPase. Okay, it is known as sodium potassium ATPase. Now, what is the action of digoxin? This digoxin, it will come from outside and it will block, it will competitively blocks, it competitively blocks potassium binding site on this channel sodium potassium ATPase. This is the channel sodium potassium ATPase. Because of this reason, the potassium will not come inside, and because of this reason, the sodium will not move outside. Okay, so can we say that digoxin is a competitive inhibitor of potassium? Okay, digoxin is a competitive inhibitor of potassium. So if I ask you that if there is digoxin toxicity, if there is digoxin toxicity, the antidote for digoxin should be to overcome the effect of digoxin. The antidote you will be giving in digoxin toxicity to overcome the effect will be potassium. Potassium will be the antidote for digoxin poisoning. And my second question is, if outside in the blood the potassium is low, there is hypokalemia, what do you think? Hypokalemia will increase the binding of digoxin or decrease? Can we say if outside potassium is low, hypokalemia, this digoxin can very easily bind to this sodium potassium ATPase? So hypokalemia may cause increased binding, which may increase the effect of digoxin, which may produce toxicity. Okay, so remember, hypokalemia, because of less potassium in the blood, digoxin can easily bind to the sodium potassium ATPase, and hypokalemia causes digoxin toxicity. And the antidote for digoxin toxicity will be potassium. So antidote will be potassium to treat digoxin toxicity. Just remember this point. Okay, now can we say digoxin has blocked this sodium potassium ATPase by blocking potassium side? Because of this reason, the potassium is not coming into the cell and sodium is not moving outside the cell. Can we say that sodium level inside the cell increases? Sodium level inside the cell increases. This sodium indirectly increases calcium level inside the cell. This sodium indirectly increases calcium level in the cell. Sir, how it increases calcium level in the cell? Let's just see how. Let's see how it increases calcium level in the cell. Suppose this is the heart cell membrane. This is the heart cell membrane. Now there is one more channel on the heart. There is one more channel on the heart. That channel is, the channel function is to bring sodium inside and to remove calcium outside. Let's call this channel as sodium calcium exchanger. Okay, in short form we will write the name of this channel as NCX. This channel is known as NCX. Now the function of this NCX channel is to bring sodium inside, to increase the concentration of sodium. But already the sodium is already very high inside. So do we need the action of this channel? If sodium is already very high inside, we don't need any more sodium. So increase in sodium inhibit this channel. Increase in sodium inhibit NCX channel. If this channel is inhibited, the potassium calcium will not move outside, and because of this reason the calcium level increases. Okay, increase in sodium level inside the cell inhibits the activity of sodium calcium exchanger. So it inhibits this channel, increase in sodium. Because of this reason calcium level increases. Now the point is, this calcium increases binding of myosin with actin. Suppose these are myosin and actin filaments present on heart. Myosin and actin bind with the help of calcium. If there is more calcium, there will be more binding of actin and myosin. More binding of actin and myosin will increase force of contraction. It will increase force of contraction, and this is known as inotropic effect. This is known as inotropic effect. So this is how the digoxin function. So the first step of, let's repeat this point. First step of digoxin function is, it inhibits sodium potassium ATPase by blocking potassium binding site. Hence potassium we will give to overcome the effect. And hypokalemia, low potassium, increases binding, causes toxicity. When we inhibit this channel, the level of sodium increases. This level, high level of sodium inhibit NCX channel. If NCX channel is not functioning, the calcium is not moving outside, the sodium is not coming inside. So that is why sodium indirectly increases calcium level by inhibiting NCX channel. Okay, now more calcium will cause more binding of actin and myosin. It will increase force of contraction, hence it will produce inotropic effect. So this is the mechanism of action of digoxin. Let's talk about now chemical properties of digoxin or pharmacokinetics of digoxin. okay, pharmacokinetics of digoxin. So we will write digoxin, it can be given orally, it can be given by injection, this is the route of administration, and when it is given orally, it comes only 60 to 80% into the blood. So it is the bioavailability of digoxin. Oral bioavailability of digoxin is 60 to 80%. Second point, when it comes into the blood, so when it is given, it will come into the blood by crossing intestine from in, sorry, so when you give this digoxin orally, it will come into the blood. When it will come into the blood, it binds to plasma proteins. It binds to plasma proteins, and plasma protein binding is 25%. So 80% will absorb, 60 to 80%. When it will come into the blood, only 25% will be bound to plasma protein. Okay, rest of this digoxin will go and deposited in tissues. Rest of this digoxin, it gets mainly deposited in tissue. It mainly gets deposited in muscles. It mainly gets deposited in muscles and on cardiac muscle, and it inhibits sodium potassium ATPase. Now any drug which goes outside, not remain inside the blood and goes deposited into the muscle, you will write any drug which has a very high extravascular deposition into the tissue, this drug has very high volume of distribution. Digoxin has high volume of distribution. Okay, because it is moving outside the blood vessel and it is getting deposited in tissue. It's around 450 liters of plasma. Okay, because of this reason, if there is digoxin poisoning, you take out the blood of the patient, you will not find digoxin in this blood. So in digoxin poisoning, because of high volume of distribution, there is no role of hemodialysis. There is no role of hemodialysis in digoxin poisoning. There is no role of hemodialysis in digoxin poisoning. Why? Because digoxin has high volume of distribution. High volume of distribution means the blood will not remain inside the blood. The drug will not remain inside the blood. It will be deposited in tissue. So in hemodialysis, we take out the blood of the patient. Okay. Now, half-life of digoxin is 40 hours. Okay. The half-life of digoxin is 40 hours. So can we say digoxin is a very long-acting drug? Digoxin is a very long acting drug. So if you want to produce immediate action of digoxin, it will be a very long acting drug. When you will give it, will take very long time to produce effect. If you want to produce immediate effect, hence to produce immediate effect, we give IV loading dose. We give IV loading dose of digoxin. And when you are giving digoxin orally continuously, it will take 4 to 5 half-lives to produce complete effect. The complete effect of digoxin comes after 4 to 5 half-life. So complete digitalization takes how much time? It takes 5 to 8 days. The complete effect of digoxin when it is given on regular basis takes 5 to 8 days. Okay. Now how digoxin is metabolized or removed in our body? Digoxin is a substrate of P-glycoprotein. Digoxin is a substrate of P-glycoprotein. Now what do we mean by the P-glycoprotein? P-glycoprotein is a transporter which is present on cells. It is present on cells, let's say intestinal cells. These are the intestinal cell. If you are giving a drug, can we say a drug has to cross intestinal cells and it will then come into the blood? What is this P-glycoprotein? P-glycoprotein is an efflux transporter. If any drug, if P-glycoprotein identifies any drug, that means P-glycoprotein identifies digoxin. Hence, digoxin is a substrate. And this digoxin, if it is identified by P-glycoprotein, P-glycoprotein will hold this digoxin and remove again back. It will remove back digoxin back into the feces. Okay. So it will decrease the absorption of digoxin through the intestine. Because this P-glycoprotein is an efflux transporter. Efflux means it will efflux back digoxin. It will not allow digoxin to get absorbed. Okay. Now the point is, sir, there are certain drugs which can increase or decrease the activity of P glycoprotein. The drugs which can increase the activity of P glycoprotein are verapamil and quinidine. The drug which can decrease the activity, I'm really sorry, the drug which can decrease the activity of P glycoprotein are verapamil and diltiazem, quinidine. The drug which can increase the activity of P glycoprotein, you'll write rifampicin. Okay. Now the point is, if you have decreased the activity of P glycoprotein is inhibited. Can we say more amount of digoxin will be absorbed into the blood? It will not get effluxed back. Hence, these two drugs, they increase digoxin toxicity because more of this digoxin will come into the blood. Okay? Because it is inhibiting the activity of P glycoprotein. And the drug which increases the activity of P glycoprotein will cause more removal of digoxin back into the feces. So it will cause digoxin, it will reduce the effect of digoxin. So digoxin will not come into the blood. So digoxin resistance will occur. Okay. Let's move forward. How digoxin is eliminated out of the body? Digoxin is eliminated purely in urine. Okay. You'll write it is not metabolized in liver. Digoxin is not metabolized in liver. When we give digoxin into the blood, it directly goes into the urine and through kidney it will be eliminated through glomerular filtration. Because of this reason, if the patient is having kidney failure, can we say the glomerular filtration decreases? Digoxin is absolutely contraindicated in kidney failure. We never give digoxin in kidney failure. Why? Because the digoxin will not get eliminated out of the body. It will become more in the body and hence it will produce toxicity. Sir, what about liver failure? Digoxin is absolutely safe in liver failure. So we will write this point. Digoxin is contraindicated in renal failure. Why? Because it gets eliminated out of the body through urine by glomerular filtration. In kidney failure, the digoxin will not eliminate it. Okay, but it is safe in liver failure. There was a similar drug which we discussed, was digitoxin. Digitoxin, remember, it is removed in bile. Because of this reason, digitoxin is safe in renal failure. So this point you must remember. Digoxin is contraindicated in renal failure. Why? Because it is purely eliminated out in urine. While digitoxin is eliminated out in bile. Hence, it is safe in cases of renal failure. Now the last point with pharmacokinetics of digoxin is, digoxin is a narrow therapeutic index drug. It's a narrow therapeutic index drug. That means it has a very low safety margin. That means if you will little bit increase the dose of digoxin, it will produce toxicity. That is why digoxin requires monitoring. That monitoring is known as therapeutic drug monitoring. Because if we increase the dose of digoxin, it causes toxicity. So what range of the digoxin should be present in the blood in which it will produce beneficial effect, not harmful effect? So the therapeutic range, or the limited, which is available range in the blood in which it will be given in our patient, which will produce beneficial effect in blood, digoxin should be present between 1.5 to 2 nanogram per ml. More than 1.2, it will produce toxicity. This is the safety limit of digoxin. In the blood, digoxin should be present in this range. It should not be more than 1.2. Hence, that is why to maintain this range, we continuously do monitoring with digoxin. We repetitively take out the blood sample and we see the blood range of digoxin. Okay, so this is all about the pharmacokinetics of digoxin. Now let's talk about uses. You'll write digoxin, it is the drug of choice as an inotropic drug in chronic heart failure. In chronic heart failure, we don't have any other drug as an inotrope. Now the point is, in chronic heart failure, which type? You will write systolic heart failure, when the heart is unable to pump out the blood forward, which is also known as heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. Heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, it is given in this case. Okay, remember, there is no role of digoxin in diastolic heart failure. There is no role of digoxin in diastolic heart failure. Okay, now there is one very important cause of diastolic heart failure, when the heart is unable to relax. Remember, digoxin is absolutely contraindicated in HOCM. HOCM stands for hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. What happens in hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy? The heart muscles are very enlarged. The heart is unable to relax properly. It's a kind of diastolic heart failure. Okay, remember this part. And also, digoxin is absolutely contraindicated in cases of high output heart failure. It is absolutely contraindicated in high output heart failure. It is only given in low output heart failure. Low output heart failure occurs when there is some damage to the heart. High output heart failure occurs when the heart is normal, the demand of the peripheral organ increases. Okay, so these are the two absolute contraindication of giving digoxin. It is not given in high output heart failure or HOCM. It is only given in low output heart failure, which is also known as systolic heart failure or reduced ejection fraction. So it is known as low output heart failure, because inotropic drug, they will increase cardiac output. So it is only given in low output heart failure. Now there is one more second use of digoxin. The second use of digoxin, digoxin is also given in cases of supra ventricular tachycardia. Short form, it is known as SVT. Okay, supra ventricular tachycardia, like atrial flutter and atrial fibrillation. Okay, now why we are giving digoxin in cases of supraventricular tachycardia? The reason is, suppose, sir, this is the heart, and remember, this is SA node, this is AV node, this is bundle of His, this is Purkinje fibers. Okay, this is heart. Now remember, in heart there are two types of arrhythmia. One is ventricle, known as ventricular tachycardia, and above ventricle is supraventricular tachycardia, which occurs in atria. Remember, this ventricle is, remember, ventricle, when pump the blood, it is known as cardiac output. The blood which is pumped by the ventricle goes to the organ. If there is ventricular tachycardia, there is ineffective contraction. Because of this reason, the cardiac output falls. It's a very dangerous condition, emergency condition, ventricular tachycardia. What about atria? When the atria is beating ineffectively in a very high heart rate, remember, it is not an emergency. It is not an emergency, because the ventricle are absolutely normal. Ventricle are responsible for cardiac output. Now the point is, if there is supraventricular tachycardia, atrial flutter and fibrillation, atria is beating very high, the patient is generally asymptomatic. The main treatment of SVT or supraventricular tachycardia is to prevent VT. We have to inhibit these impulse. We have to inhibit these high impulse to reach into the ventricle. The main treatment of SVT is to prevent VT. Because if ventricular tachyarrhythmia will occur, the patient will die suddenly. Now we know that all impulses from atria, they come into the ventricle through a node known as AV node. Hence, how we can prevent the entry of atrial impulse to the ventricle? By inhibiting AV node. So in treatment of supraventricular tachycardia, the drug we give are AV nodal blockers. We give AV node blockers to prevent VT. The main treatment of SVT is to prevent VT by blocking AV node, because from atria impulses come to the ventricle through AV node. And we know digoxin blocks AV node. Digoxin blocks AV node, hence it is given in cases of supraventricular tachycardia to prevent VT or ventricular tachycardias. Okay. Now there is one more property of digoxin. When we give in SVT, digoxin also converts atrial flutter into atrial fibrillation. It also converts atrial flutter into fibrillation, because like vagus nerve also converts flutter into fibrillation. It's a vagomimetic effect. It decreases effective refractory period. Now in case of AV nodal blocker, it is a very good thing. It's a good thing. Why? Because the impulse which will come to this AV node in cases of fibrillation will become homogeneous. Okay. So remember two points with digoxin. Why we give digoxin in SVT? Because it blocks AV node, and additionally it converts atrial flutter into atrial fibrillation. In presence of AV node block, fibrillation is a better thing. The impulses will come in a regular way and AV node will respond in a very good way. Okay. So these are the two reasons why we give SVT: block AV node and to convert flutter into fibrillation. These are the two effects of digoxin. So these are the two uses of digoxin. Now let's talk about side effects of digoxin. Side effect of digoxin. First we will write non-cardiac side effect. The most common side effect of digoxin is nausea and vomiting. Okay. It also causes abdominal pain, because it leads to mesenteric ischemia. It produces vasoconstriction in GIT vessels. Okay. It also causes gynecomastia. And lastly, it causes yellow vision. It causes yellow vision. Now, yellow vision is also known as xanthopsia. Or you will write color halos. It causes color halos. Okay. Now, one electrolyte imbalance with digoxin can cause. Digoxin causes hyperkalemia. Why? By inhibiting sodium potassium ATPase, the potassium will not go into the muscles. The potassium will not go into the muscle. Hence, in the blood, potassium level will increase. Okay. So remember one point where we generally get confused. Remember, digoxin toxicity occur in hypokalemia. Why? Because outside, if there is low potassium, digoxin can bind easily. But digoxin toxicity results in hyperkalemia. Okay. Digoxin itself causes hyperkalemia, but hypokalemia may result in digoxin toxicity. Okay. So digoxin toxicity occur in hypokalemia, while digoxin toxicity will result to hyperkalemia. Okay. So this is a confusing term. Just try to remember this point. Now these are the non-cardiac side effects of digoxin. So most of them, they are not very dangerous. Let's talk about now cardiac side effects. Cardiac side effects of digoxin. In cardiac side effect, you will write digoxin produces arrhythmias. Digoxin produces arrhythmias. Some of them can be very dangerous. So you will write most common arrhythmia produced by digoxin. So you'll write arrhythmias due to digoxin. Okay. Most common arrhythmias caused by digoxin is ventricular bigeminy, which is sometimes known as extrasystole. Ventricle will beat one extra time. Okay. So hence the pulse will come instead of one, instead of one, two pulse will come. Now this is not a dangerous arrhythmia, no treatment is required. Okay, most fatal arrhythmia is ventricular fibrillation. A patient will die suddenly, pulseless. The person will become pulseless. There is no effective contraction. The person will die. Okay. And sometimes it can also lead to biventricular tachycardia. Again, a very dangerous condition, but the most fatal is ventricular fibrillation. Okay. Ventricular fibrillation. Okay. Remember that part. Third, most characteristic arrhythmia. Most characteristic arrhythmia caused by digoxin, you will write non-PSVT with variable heart block. Okay, non-PSVT means it causes atrial fibrillation. Non-PSVT means it causes atrial fibrillation. Variable heart block means it causes AV node block. Okay, so this is the exact name. And the last point is the arrhythmia which digoxin will never cause. Digoxin never causes, you will write atrial flutter. Digoxin never causes atrial flutter. Why? Because digoxin can convert flutter into fibrillation. That is why. So these are the arrhythmias which are caused by digoxin. Most common is ventricular bigeminy or one extra time ventricle will beat, non-symptomatic. Most dangerous is ventricular fibrillation. And most characteristic is non-PSVT with variable heart block. That means atria will beat more and AV node will be blocked below it. And it will never cause atrial flutter. Now let's talk about the treatment of digoxin-induced arrhythmias. Treatment of arrhythmias caused by digoxin. Okay. Now suppose, sir, this is the heart. This is the heart. Now, overall, digoxin may cause tachycardia. And overall, digoxin may cause bradycardia. Whole heart will beat more, whole heart will beat less. Okay, and due to ectopic foci, digoxin may only cause SVT. SVT stand for supraventricular tachycardia. That means atria will beat more, or it may cause only and only VT, ventricular tachycardias, like ventricular fibrillation, etc. Okay, if there is tachycardia, the drug of choice for digoxin toxicity is potassium chloride. The drug of choice for tachycardia due to digoxin is potassium chloride. Drug of choice for bradycardia due to digoxin poisoning is atropin. Remember, any bradycardia, you can blindly mark the answer atropin. Atropin is the only drug we have for bradycardia. But what is the definitive treatment? We have to add an artificial pacemaker. We have to put an artificial pacemaker also. Now, if there is supraventricular tachycardia, that means atria is beating more, the drug of choice is propranolol or beta blockers. Okay, and if this is VT, VT is a very dangerous condition. Okay, so you will write the drug of choice is VT due to digoxin is lignocaine or phenytoin. But among them, lignocaine is the drug of choice. And you will write these two drugs are class 1B antiarrhythmic drug. They are class B1B antiarrhythmic drugs. So this is the treatment of digoxin-induced arrhythmias. So if there is tachycardia, we give potassium chloride. If there is bradycardia, we give atropin. If there is supraventricular tachycardia, then we give propranolol. If the most dangerous one, ventricular tachyarrhythmias, the drug of choice is lignocaine or phenytoin. Overall, the drug of choice is lignocaine. Okay. Now, the next point is ECG changes with digoxin. ECG changes. Now you know that the normal ECG is just something like this. This is a P wave. P wave represents atrial depolarization. Then we have QRS complex. It represents ventricular depolarization. And then we have T wave. It tells us about ventricular repolarization. T wave, ventricular repolarization. How it occurs? P wave comes because of when sodium comes inside atria. QRS complex comes when sodium comes inside ventricle. And T wave comes when potassium moves outside ventricle. Okay? And we know what happens with digoxin. Inside the cell, sodium level is high and calcium level is high, but there is no potassium because potassium is not coming inside. Okay? Keep this thing in mind. The first ECG changes with digoxin is increase in PR interval. First changes increase in PR interval. Why? Because digoxin blocks PR interval, signifies AV node. It blocks AV node. That is why there is increase in PR interval. Okay. Second point is narrow QRS complex. Because already sodium and calcium is very high, which is also known as shortening of QT interval. Shortening of QT interval. Why? Because of very high amount of sodium and positive charge inside the ventricles. Third point you will write, it will also lead to ST depression with T wave inversion. ST depression with T wave inversion. That means the ST segment will become just like this. It will become something like this. Instead of normal, it will become like this. Why? Because there is no potassium to move outside. So, okay. So, it will become something like this. Okay. So, ST depression with T wave inversion because there is no potassium which can bring out T wave. Now, the point is normally we make a tick like this. This is a normal tick. If you are seeing this ST segment, it is becoming like this. This is known as reverse tick sign. Reverse tick sign of digoxin. ST depression with T wave inversion is the reverse tick sign because of low potassium. Okay. Now let's talk about digoxin toxicity and management. Let's talk about digoxin toxicity. Okay. Now you will write, if there is chronic digoxin toxicity, the drug of choice is potassium chloride because it will be an antidote. But if the patient has taken, let's say, 50 tablets of digoxin, acute digoxin poisoning. In acute digoxin poisoning, remember, we don't give no role of potassium chloride. There is no role of potassium chloride. Okay. Why there is no role of potassium chloride? When a patient has taken digoxin suddenly the sodium potassium ATPase has inhibited. In acute digoxin poisoning, there is already sudden hyperkalemia. There is already hyperkalemia. That is why. Okay. Because of sudden inhibition of sodium potassium ATPase, potassium is not coming. Remember, in acute digoxin poisoning, there is no role of hemodialysis. There is no role of hemodialysis. Why? Digoxin has a very high volume of distribution. It will not be present in the blood. It will be attached to the muscles. Okay. And there is no role of forced diuresis. Full diuresis, we give diuretics to remove the digoxin. Sir, we don't give diuretics because diuretics, they cause hypokalemia. If there is hypokalemia, more digoxin will able to bind on sodium potassium ATPase. It will cause more toxicity. Okay. So what is the treatment of acute digoxin poisoning? The drug of choice for acute digoxin poisoning, it is the most effective drug we have. The best drug for acute digoxin poisoning is Digibind, which is also known as Digifab. The drug of choice for acute digoxin poisoning, or overall in one word, if nothing is mentioned, the drug of choice for digoxin poisoning is Digibind. If nothing is mentioned, even then it will be the drug of choice, because it can be used anywhere, okay, in any type of digoxin poisoning. Now, what is Digibind? You will write, Digibind is a Fab fragment monoclonal antibody against digoxin. It's a Fab fragment monoclonal antibody against digoxin. Now, you know that suppose this is the structure of an antibody. The above portion is known as Fab portion, and the below portion is known as Fc portion of any antibody. And this Fab portion binds to antigen. So this Fab portion binds to digoxin, and it will block the action of digoxin on muscles. Okay. Now in this antibody, what we have done, we have removed this Fc portion. We have removed this Fc portion. Okay. So this Fc portion has now been removed. So this only Fab fragment binds to digoxin. This is Digibind. Okay, it's a Fab fragment monoclonal antibody against digoxin. Now let's talk about drug interactions of digoxin and contraindication. Drug interactions. Most of the drug interaction we have already discussed. Digoxin is absolutely contraindicated with thiazides. Sorry, not contraindicated. Precaution should be taken with thiazide and loop diuretics, because thiazides and loop diuretics, they cause hypokalemia, and hypokalemia increases binding of digoxin. It leads to digoxin toxicity. Hypokalemia causes digoxin toxicity. Second point is, we have already discussed verapamil and quinidine. Verapamil and quinidine, they inhibit P-glycoprotein. Because of this reason, the absorption of digoxin and its elimination will be reduced. It will also lead to increase in toxicity. Okay. And the last point you will write, certain drugs like cholestyramine. Okay. Antacids and metoclopromide, they reduce the absorption of digoxin from GIT. They reduce the absorption of digoxin from GIT. So generally, we should not combine digoxin with these drugs, because these drugs, they generally suppress intestinal motility. So because of that reason, last point is contraindications. Contraindications of digoxin use. Okay. Now you can make a mnemonic. Digoxin is contraindicated in weak heart. So these are the contraindication. Digoxin, in case of digoxin, we never give cardioversion. We never do cardioversion in cases of digoxin poisoning, because it can lead to fibrillation. Digoxin is absolutely contraindicated in WPW syndrome. WPW syndrome. WPW syndrome is also known as Wolf, Parkinson, White syndrome. Now what happens in Wolf, Parkinson, White syndrome? Suppose this is a heart, and you know that in heart normally there is SA node. This SA node stimulates AV node, and this AV node bundle of his and Purkinje fiber. This is the normal conductive pathway of heart. What happens in Wolf, Parkinson, White syndrome? Apart from this normal pathway, there is one abnormal conductive pathway. There is one abnormal conductive pathway. This abnormal conductive pathway is sometimes known as bundle of Kent. Now the point is, sir, why we don't give digoxin in WPW syndrome? Because digoxin blocks AV node. Digoxin blocks AV node. If you will block this AV node, K can we say the normal conduction will become slow? If you will block this AV node, the normal conduction will become slow and the conduction from abnormal conductive pathway will increase. Okay? The abnormal conductive pathway is very fast. It will lead to ventricular fibrillation and the patient may die suddenly. Okay? So it will increase the conduction from abnormal conductive pathway. Okay? H stands for, you will write, it is contraindicated in hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, which we have already discussed. It is absolutely contraindicated in high output heart failure, which we have already discussed. High output heart failure. Now, E stands for electrolyte imbalance. This is a very important point. In certain electrolyte abnormality, we'd never give digoxin. You'll write, digoxin is absolutely contraindicated in cases of hypokalemia, because hypokalemia causes digoxin toxicity. Okay, binding. It is absolutely contraindicated in hypercalcemia, because already calcium is very high. Calcium will is very high inside the cell. If more calcium will come inside the cell, it will lead to toxicity of digoxin, hypercalcemia. And it is absolutely contraindicated in hypomagnesemia, decrease in magnesium. The reason is, in our body, magnesium inhibit calcium. Magnesium inhibit calcium. If there is hypomagnesemia, it behaves like hypercalcemia. In our body, magnesium inhibit calcium channel. If there is hypomagnesemia, more calcium will go inside the heart cell. Digoxin toxicity will increase. Okay. Second point, next point is, you will write, if there is already AV node block, because digoxin also causes AV node block, it will lead to complete heart block. Next point is, digoxin is contraindicated in renal failure, because digoxin is eliminated from urine through glomerular filtration. It is absolutely contraindicated in renal failure, but you will write, digoxin is safe in hepatic failure. In liver disease, it's safe drug. It is contraindicated in renal failure only. And lastly, in thyroid abnormalities, digoxin should not be given in hyperthyroidism, because there is already very high chances of arrhythmias in hyperthyroidism. It should not be given in hypothyroidism as well, which is also known as mixed edema. Okay, hypo and hyperthyroidism precipitates arrhythmias. So these are the contraindications of digoxin. So digoxin is, mnemonic is, digoxin is contraindicated in weak heart. C for cardioversion, WPW syndrome, HOCM, hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, high output heart failure, electrolyte imbalance, AV nodal block, renal failure, and thyroid abnormality. So this completes our digoxin. Before saying goodbye, remember, there is a new drug which is right now not approved, that is istaroxime. Istaroxime is a same drug like digoxin that means it also inhibits sodium potassium ATPase, but it is right now in clinical trial. It is found to be more safer as compared to digoxin. It is safer. So it's a new drug which is under clinical development right now. It is not approved. So this completes our chronic heart failure. I hope you enjoyed this lecture. Thank you. Hello all, now today we will be discussing about acute decompensated heart failure. Now, what do we mean by the acute word, acute decompensated heart failure? It means it is sudden worsening in the symptoms of heart failure.
okay? It is the sudden worsening of the symptoms of heart failure. Now, what symptoms a patient will have in cases of sudden heart failure? Suppose this is the heart and this is the left ventricle which is pumping out the blood. So if there is sudden functioning, dysfunctioning of left ventricle, this left ventricle will not able to pump the blood forward, and hence because of this reason, the perfusion pressure to the organs will decrease. Okay, the perfusion pressure becomes low or it becomes decreases. Because of this reason, the person will not able to do work because the organs are not receiving ample amount of blood. The patient will have a symptom of fatigue. Okay. So when the left ventricle is not able to pump the blood towards the organ, the perfusion of the blood towards the organ will decrease and the patient will have symptoms of fatigue. Now, what could be the other symptoms a patient would be suffering from? Remember, the blood to the left ventricle, it comes from the lungs. Okay, if the left ventricle is not functioning, there will be pulmonary congestion. The blood will be collected in lungs. There will be pulmonary congestion. And because of this reason, the patient will have difficulty in breathing because the blood is collected in lungs. Okay, so the oxygen will not able to diffuse. So the patient will be having symptom of dyspnea, difficulty in breathing. Okay, so how do we measure this pulmonary congestion? Pulmonary congestion is measured by putting a catheter directly into pulmonary capillaries. Pulmonary congestion is measured by a parameter known as PCWP. PCWP stands for pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. We put one special catheter known as Swan-Ganz catheter through which we measure. Okay, and if there is a component of right heart failure, the blood will be not able to pump towards the heart. Okay, so if a component of right ventricular failure is there, remember the blood will be collected in different organs and the patient will have symptoms of congestion. Okay, so the blood will be collected in different organs. The third symptom the patient will have, symptoms of congestion. Okay, so these are the three areas when the blood is not moving towards the organ. The blood is collected in the lungs and the blood is collected in the organs. Okay, so hence the patient will have symptoms of congestion. So these are the various features a patient generally suffers from. Congestion you can see in the organs, like swelling of the organs, and there will be edema. Now let's see what is the management of acute heart failure. Okay, let's see what is the management of acute heart failure. So okay, let's see the management. Now there are two goals of therapy. The first goal of therapy, we have to improve perfusion pressure. That means we have to tell the heart to pump this blood towards the organ. Okay, so we have to stimulate the heart to increase the cardiac output. Hence we give inotropic drugs. Inotropic drugs, they will stimulate this right ventricle, left ventricle, and it will pump the blood towards the organ. Okay, left ventricle, inotropic drug. And the definitive treatment is, you will write, is left ventricular assist device. Or if there is severe damage to the heart failure, cardiac transplantation. Okay, put a new heart. Okay, so the drugs which we will be using in telling the heart to pump more blood is inotropic drug. They will increase cardiac output and hence they will pump more blood towards the organ. Okay, inotropic drug. But the definitive treatment is to put a mechanical device which will pump the heart. And to improve the symptoms of congestion and pulmonary edema, we use two classes of drug. One we use is diuretics and second we use is vasodilators. Okay, we use either diuretics or vasodilators to improve the symptoms of pulmonary congestion or and the swelling of the pulmonary edema or the whole body swelling. Okay, now which diuretic we will use? You will write, we prefer to use the drug of choice is loop diuretics. The drug of choice is loop diuretics, but we add other also. Then we add other diuretic as well. Now among vasodilators, we will write there are three drugs which we use. One is nitrates, second is nitroprusside, and the last one we have is natriuretic peptides. Okay, natriuretic peptides. So these are the drugs we use, and there is one technique which we can employ to remove this excess amount of fluid from the body. We can use ultrafiltration, also known as aquapheresis. Aquapheresis is a technique in which we remove excess of water and sodium, which is seen in cases of heart failure. Okay, we will remove excess of fluid like sodium and water out of the body directly through a machine. So this is the all treatment options we have in cases of acute decompensated heart failure. Now let's see which drug to be used where. Okay, so let's talk about first inotropic drugs. Okay, let's make a heading, inotropic drugs. Inotropic drugs. Now what is the definition of inotropic drugs? These drugs, they increase cardiac output, okay, by directly stimulating the heart. Because of this reason, they will increase perfusion pressure. They will increase perfusion pressure. That means they will increase the blood supply to the tissue. They will increase the blood supply to the tissue. Okay, now in which cases of acute decompensated heart failure we give inotropic drug in cases of when the cardiac output is low. So it is given in low output state. When the cardiac output is low, that means perfusion pressure is low, and the sometimes we give when the patient is having blood pressure less than 70 millimeter of mercury. Okay, and the patient is going into cardiogenic shock. Okay, patient is undergoing into cardiogenic shock. When the perfusion pressure becomes so critically narrow, when the patient is having very less BP means hypotension, then this condition is known as cardiogenic shock. Okay, now let's see what are the different drugs we have. We will write certain points that all these inotropic drugs are, all these drugs, what are their route of administration? All these drugs are intravenous drugs. Okay, all inotropic drugs are intravenous drug except one, except digoxin. Digoxin is an oral inotropic drug. Because of this reason, digoxin is not mainly used in acute heart failure. Digoxin is a drug of choice in chronic heart failure. We use digoxin is chronic heart failure, not in acute heart failure. So in acute decompensated heart failure, we will be using intravenous drugs. Now let's see what are the drugs we have. Okay, let's see various drugs. The first class of drug we have is beta agonist. The first class of drug we have is beta agonist. Why? Because these drugs, they will stimulate beta 1 receptor on heart. And if we stimulate beta 1 receptor on heart, the heart increases cardiac output. The cardiac output of the heart increases. Second class of drug we have is, you will write as inodilators. Okay, so these are the two classes of drugs we have. Okay, and inodilators, I will be telling you, they are even more effective drug than beta 2 agonist. And after that, we will write certain newer drugs. Just write the names of new drugs. Right now they are not approved. But let's write their names. The first drug is omecamtiv. What is omecamtiv? Omecamtiv is a myosin activator. Right now not approved. So if we activate myosin, the contraction of heart will increase. Second drug you will write is istaroxime. Istaroxime is just like digoxin, sodium potassium ATPase inhibitor. Just like digoxin. And the third drug you will write is C-relaxin. C-relaxin is a recombinant human relaxin protein. And this relaxin protein stimulates cardiac muscles, inotropic agent. Plus it has vasodilating property as well. These drugs you will just write for your reference right now because they are not approved. So what we have to discuss in great detail, is about beta agonist and inodilators. These drugs are approved and the question is very commonly asked about these two drugs. So let's start with the first one, that is beta agonist. Let's make a heading, beta agonist. Okay. These beta agonists are sympathomimetic drug because beta 1 receptor is sympatho, it is a sympathetic receptor. So it's a sympathomimetic drugs. They act on beta 1 receptor on heart, and when we stimulate this beta 1 receptor, when we stimulate beta 1 receptor, beta 1 receptor are of GS type. It increases cyclic AMP inside the heart, and cyclic AMP increases inotropic activity. It increases force of contraction. Okay, that means it increases force of contraction. But remember, they have other action as well. They also increases chronotrophic activity. Chronotrophic means they increase heart rate by stimulating SA node. They also have dromotrophic activity. Dromotrophic means they increase conduction through AV node and other fibers. Okay. And lastly, they also have bathymotrophic activity. Bathymotrophic means they increase excitability of tissue. Okay, they increase excitability of the tissue. So they are inotropic, chronotrophic, dromotrophic and bathymotrophic. Okay, now let's see what are the drugs we have among beta 2 agonists. Let's see, we have three drugs we are having which are used in acute decompensated heart failure. The first is norepinephrine. Second you will write is dobutamine. And the third drug we have is dopamine. Okay, these three drugs we generally use in heart failure. Now you will write, this norepinephrine acts on beta 1 receptor as well as alpha 1 receptors. Okay, now where this norepinephrine is used, this norepinephrine is the drug of choice. It is the drug of choice for cardiogenic shock. Cardiogenic shock means acute decompensated heart failure, AD, acute decompensated heart failure, when the BP is less than 70 millimeter of mercury. When the blood pressure falls below 70, then the drug of choice is norepinephrine. The reason is why? The reason is, as it is acting on beta 1, it will have inotropic activity. Inotropic activity, which is desired in acute decompensated heart failure. As it acts on alpha 1 receptor, it is a vasoconstrictor. It acts as a vasoconstrictor and it will try to increase this fall blood pressure. Okay, this fall the blood pressure which has been decreased due to the property of vasoconstrictor, it will increase the blood pressure as well. Okay, so norepinephrine will act on beta 1 and alpha 1 and it will be used in cardiogenic shock. Now what is the dose of norepinephrine? You will write, the dose is 0.2 to 1.0 microgram per kg per minute. So it is given as a continuous infusion. Okay, it is given as a continuous infusion. Now next point is dobutamine. Dobutamine is a specific beta 1 agonist. It does not act on alpha 1 receptor. Because of this reason, dobutamine is the most preferred drug or the drug of choice in acute decompensated heart failure without hypotension. Acute decompensated heart failure, if the blood pressure is more than 70, the blood pressure is maintained. Why? Because it will only stimulate the heart. Okay, now what is the dose? You will write it only acts on beta 1. The dose is 2 to 8 microgram per kg per minute of continuous infusion. Okay, of continuous infusion. Now can we say that this dobutamine will not have any effect on, no effect on blood vessels? No effect on blood vessels. So can we say it will not produce any vasoconstriction unlike norepinephrine? Because of this reason, it has no effect on total peripheral resistance. Total peripheral resistance, that means when the blood vessel becomes constricted, when the blood vessel becomes constricted, there is increase in TPR, total peripheral resistance. It has no effect on total peripheral resistance. Second point is it has no effect on coronary vessels as well. It has no effect on coronary vessels as well. It will not constrict, not dilate coronary vessels. So it will just have the effect on heart because it is a specific beta 1 agonist. It has no effect on blood vessels. That is why this dobutamine is also the drug of choice just to stimulate the heart during stress echo. During stress echo, when we want to stimulate the heart and when we want to assess the activity of heart, we give dobutamine and stress PET scan. Okay, and just remember why we are giving this dobutamine continuously as an IV infusion, because it's a very short acting drug. Its half-life is just 120 seconds. Its half-life is just 120 seconds. That is why. Okay, now next drug we have is dopamine. If we talk about dopamine, the effect of dopamine is according to receptor. Its effect is according to the receptors. Okay, now let's see the effect of dopamine. We will write down, okay, the effect of dopamine. Now when you use this dopamine in a dose of 1 to 2 microgram per kg per minute, again a continuous infusion, this dopamine acts on specific D1 receptors, dopamine 1 receptors, which are present on kidney, and it produces vasodilatation in kidney. It produces vasodilatation in kidney. Because of this reason, this dopamine is the drug of choice for acute renal failure. Because in acute renal failure, the blood supply to the kidney decreases, which is also known as oliguria. It is a drug of choice for acute renal failure, which is also seen in heart failure as well. Okay, it is seen in heart failure. Second, you will write at the dose of 2 to 10 microgram per kg per minute, again continuous infusion, this dopamine will act on beta 1 receptors present on heart. This beta 1 receptors, which are present on heart, and at this dose it can be used for the treatment of acute decompensated heart failure. Acute decompensated heart failure. And if the dose is more than 10 microgram per kg per minute, this dopamine starts acting on alpha 1 receptors, which are present on blood vessels, and it produces vasoconstriction. Okay, as it is using vasoconstriction, it can be used for the treatment of hypotension. It can be used for the treatment of hypotension. Okay, now the point is, what is the therapeutic use where we will use dopamine in heart failure? Dopamine is most commonly used at a dose of 2 to 5 microgram per kg per minute. And at this dose, it will act on D1 and beta 1 receptors. Because of this reason, it is the drug of choice for acute renal failure, which is associated with heart failure. If you want to save the kidney, we give dopamine. We don't have any other option. And the use of dopamine in more than 10 microgram per kg per minute is generally avoided. It is discouraged. It is generally avoided because in such a high dose, dopamine produces various arrhythmias. It is highly arrhythmogenic, so high dose use of dopamine is generally avoided. But sometimes we can use for the treatment of hypotension, which is associated with cardiogenic heart failure. Okay, but its use is generally avoided because it is highly arrhythmogenic. Now the question arises, why it is highly arrhythmogenic? The reason is, in high dose, dopamine also release. It also helps release norepinephrine. It also releases norepinephrine from the nerves. Plus, it has also direct action. So the action of dopamine becomes very unpredictable. It also releases norepinephrine from the nerves. Okay, so these are the uses. So let's summarize. If there is cardiogenic shock, the blood pressure is less, we prefer to use norepinephrine. If the blood pressure is maintained, we prefer to use dopamine, dobutamine. And if there is renal failure, kidney failure, then we prefer to use dopamine. Okay, if there is kidney failure, then we prefer to use dopamine. Now the next class of drug we have is ionodilators. Ionodilators means these drugs are inotropic agent plus they have vasodilating property. They are also vasodilators. That is why the name came ionodilators. Okay, they are vasodilators plus well as ionodilators. Now the point is, these ionodilators, you will write, they are the most effective drug. They are the most effective drug for both right heart failure and left heart failure. They are the most effective drug, even better than beta 2 agonist. Okay, because they have additional vasodilating property. Second point, these inotropic drugs, they are the drug of choice for heart failure if the patient was on beta blockers. If the patient comes to you and gives you a history that I was on beta blocker, remember, if the patient was on beta blocker and because of beta blocker he or she have developed heart failure, remember, beta agonists are not useful. Beta agonists are not useful. Why? Because already the receptors are blocked. Hence, we will give ionodilators. Okay? Hence, we will give ionodilators. Now, let's see what are the drugs we have among ionodilators. The first drug among ionodilators we have is phosphodiesterase 3 inhibitor. Let's write the short form as PDE 3 inhibitor. Okay. Now the next drug we have is phosphodiesterase 3 inhibitor again, plus additionally you will write calcium sensitizer. And potassium channel opener. Now let's see what do we mean by this. We know that phosphodiesterase enzyme is responsible for degradation of cyclic AMP. Phosphodiesterase 3 inhibitor, they increase cyclic AMP inside the heart cells. And just like beta receptors, they were also increasing cyclic AMP. It produces inotropic effect. So what is the function of phosphodiesterase? Phosphodiesterase enzyme is responsible for degradation of cyclic AMP. Phosphodiesterase enzyme, PDE enzyme, is responsible for degradation of cyclic AMP. You inhibit this phosphodiesterase enzyme, the level of cyclic AMP inside the cell increases. Now, second point is, when this cyclic AMP increases inside the blood vessels, remember, it produces vasodilation. That is why increasing cyclic AMP, remember, It produces inotropic effect and vasodilatory effect. Hence, they are known as inodilators. Now, let's write their names. The drug which are we are having among phosphodiesterase 3 inhibitor are, you will write their names, milrinone, enamrinone, enamrinone was earlier known as amrinone. It was earlier known as amrinone. Third, you will write enoximone. And vesnarinone. And among them, this milrinone is right now an approved drug. Okay, it is an approved drug and it is considered to be the most effective drug for right heart failure. Here you will write levosimendane and pimobendane. Okay. Levosimendan and pimobendan. Now, as we are seeing, levosimendan and pimobendan, they have additional calcium sensitizing property. If we sensitize calcium to the myosin, it will additionally have inotropic property. This calcium sensitizer has additional inotropic activity apart from phosphodiesterase 3 inhibiting property. And potassium channel opener, remember, they are vasodilators. Due to potassium channel opening, they have additional vasodilating property. Okay, so these are the drug. Now we will discuss milrinone in great detail. We will write one point about levosimendan and pimobendan. Levosimendan is an approved drug for treatment of acute heart failure in humans. Pimobendan is approved in dogs for acute heart failure. Okay, pimobendan is approved in dogs. So let's make a heading milrinone. So this drug we have to discuss in detail. Okay, so let's talk about milrinone, its properties. So these drugs, phosphodiesterase inhibitor, they are the most effective drug. Okay, now this milrinone, you will write route of administration, it is given by an intravenous bolus injection. Okay, and it is contraindicated in renal failure. We know that in renal failure we give dopamine. And its side effect is, due to inhibition of phosphodiesterase 3 in platelets, it causes thrombocytopenia. It causes thrombocytopenia. Okay? So remember this point, that milrinone, all these inotropic drugs, we know they are given by IV. They are contraindicated in renal failure and milrinone causes thrombocytopenia. So it is the best drug we have. It is the most effective drug, phosphodiesterase inhibitor for heart failure. Now let's talk about other drugs. So the drugs which we use for the treatment of congestion and acute pulmonary edema. Okay. Now let's see which drug to be used where. Let's see the treatment of acute pulmonary edema. The treatment of acute pulmonary edema is LMNOP. Okay, LMNOP. So the drug of choice for acute pulmonary edema is loop diuretic. The drug of choice for acute pulmonary edema is loop diuretics. Which loop diuretic? You can use any loop diuretics. We generally use IV, furosemide, torsemide, bumetanide. Okay, what is the action of this loop diuretic in pulmonary edema? You have to remember, it is not because of their diuretic action. Their mechanism of action in loop diuretics in acute pulmonary edema is venodilatation. They produce venodilatation due to increase in prostaglandin formation. Their action is not due to diuretic action. They produce venodilatation, hence less blood will come to the heart and less blood from right heart will go to the lungs. And similarly, all other two drugs are also venodilatation. If loop diuretics are unable to produce satisfactory response, then we add morphine. If it is not controlled, then we add nitroglycerin. okay? And these two drugs are also venodilators. Okay? So these loop diuretic, they have vasodilating action. Now nitroglycerin is only used if the blood pressure is more than 110 by, if it is more than 110 millimeter of mercury. Nitroglycerin should not be used if the blood pressure is less than 110 because it leads to hypotension. Other things you will write, oxygen and prop up position. Prop up position means the patient should not lie down. If a patient will lie down, more blood will be collected in lungs, which will worsen pulmonary edema. Okay, so in acute pulmonary edema, the drug of choice is loop diuretic, add morphine and nitroglycerin, because all these drugs are venodilators. Okay, let's talk about now systemic congestion. How to treat this congestion? Or you will write edema. This edema in heart failure is known as refractory edema. The patient will have the symptoms, the patient will be having swelling over the whole body. So the drug of choice to relieve congestion in the whole body is again loop diuretics. Okay, again loop diuretics, they are the drug of choice. Now if it is not relieved, then we add thiazides. Now which thiazides? Either we can give IV chlorothalidone or we can give oral metalozone. Metalozone is safe in renal failure. It is the only thiazide which is safe in renal failure. Okay, now if we go further, if it is still not controlled, then we will add other drugs. If this edema is still not controlled, add other drugs. If the patient is having hypokalemia, then add spironolactone. It is a potassium sparing diuretic, so it will preserve potassium. Okay, potassium sparing diuretic. But remember, spironolactone is absolutely contraindicated in renal failure. It is absolutely contraindicated in renal failure if the patient GFR is less than 10 milliliter of minutes. It is absolutely contraindicated to spironolactone, because spironolactone preserves potassium, hence we give. Okay, if the patient is having still resistant edema, then we add natriuretic peptides. What are these natriuretic peptides? We will discuss shortly. And the last option we can do is ultrafiltration. Or aquapheresis. Ultrafiltration or aquapheresis means we will take out the blood of the patient directly and remove this saline and excess of water from the body. Okay, so let's make a heading, natriuretic peptides now. Okay, now these natriuretic peptides, they are used as an add-on drug. In the background of, diuretics and inotropic drug in cases of resistant heart failure. If the symptoms are not controlled by, diuretics and inotropic drugs, then we add this natriuretic peptides. Okay, now what are these natriuretic peptides? We will write, so if you talk about the normal physiology, these natriuretic peptides, they are normally synthesized in our body. they are normally synthesized in our body, and they are released, or they are released into the blood when the blood supply to the heart increases. They are released into the blood when there is increase in right atrial stretch, or you will write there is increase in central venous pressure. Now what does that mean? It means, suppose this is the heart and more supply of more blood is coming to the heart, okay, more blood is coming to the heart. So can we say in this case the heart has to function very high, the heart has to function in a very great amount. So heart, what it does, heart, it releases certain natriuretic peptides in the blood for its own protection. So heart releases this natriuretic peptides for its own protection. What these natriuretic peptide will do, these natriuretic peptides will decrease the amount of blood which is coming to the heart, okay. So these natriuretic peptides will decrease the amount of blood which is coming to the heart. Their effect in the body is, sir, they will produce natriuresis. They will produce natriuresis. That means this amount of blood will go out of the body through kidney. So it will cause diuretic action. Diuretic means this excess of fluid will go out of the body through kidney, and it also produces vasodilatation. It also produces vasodilatation, so that if there will be vasodilatation, less amount of the blood will come to the heart. So heart synthesizes this natriuretic peptides for its own protection. When the more amount of blood comes to the heart for its own protection, heart synthesizes. Now let's see what are the different natriuretic peptides which are normally present in our body. What are the different types of natriuretic peptides which are present or synthesized in our body? We will write first is ANP. ANP, A type of natriuretic peptide. Second we have is BNP. Third we have CNP. And the fourth we have is urodilantin. These are the four natriuretic peptides which are synthesized in our body. ANP stands for A type of natriuretic peptides, or it is sometimes known as atrial natriuretic peptides. Okay. Now this A type of natriuretic peptide, remember, it is synthesized by the atria or the heart. It is synthesized by the heart muscles or atria. BNP stands for B type of natriuretic peptide, which is also known as brain natriuretic peptide. Brain natriuretic peptide. Remember, it's a confusing term, although it is the name it is having is brain, but again it is synthesized by the heart, especially by ventricles. It is synthesized by atria. Now why it is known as brain? Because it was isolated from the brain. But remember, it is not synthesized by the brain, it is synthesized by the heart. CNP is C type of natriuretic peptide. It is synthesized by endothelial cells of blood vessels. And urodilantin is synthesized by the kidney. So what is their function? They produce vasodilatation and they cause diuresis through the kidney. Now sir, what we have made? We have made recombinant forms. We have made recombinant ANP form. This recombinant ANP form is we will write its name. The name of the drug which is recombinant ANP is carperitide. Carperitide. Okay. Carperitide. The second drug which we have made is recombinant BNP. Recombinant BNP analog, brain natriuretic peptide. The drug name is neseritide. The drug name is neseritide. Okay. Now the last drug we have is recombinant urodilantin. Recombinant urodilantin analog. The drug name is ularitide. The drug name is ularitide. So these are the three recombinant natriuretic peptides we have. Recombinant ANP is carperitide, BNP is neseritide, urodilantin is ularitide. Now among them, this neseritide, it is an approved drug. Right now it is an approved drug in America and India. Okay, carperitide and ularitide are not approved. They are approved in Japan. Okay, so this neseritide is an approved drug in cases of resistant heart failure. Resistant heart failure. Now, what is the route of administration of this neseritide? Remember, neseritide is again given IV. It is also given IV, and it is absolutely contraindicated in cases of hypotension. If the BP is very low, don't give this neseritide. Why? Because this neseritide itself causes, due to diuresis and vasodilatation, it itself causes hypotension. Okay, so this is all about natriuretic peptides, and this finishes our acute heart failure. Okay, this finishes our acute heart failure. So thank you very much.
Hello all. Now today we will be starting with angina. Okay, now what is angina? Angina is an ischemic pain. Okay, angina is an ischemic pain in heart, and it occurs due to reduction in coronary blood flow. Okay, due to reduction in coronary blood flow. So when the coronary arteries, which usually supply the blood to the heart, they get blocked due to some reason, there is ischemia, and due to ischemia there is a pain which is known as angina. Now remember, there are various types of angina. There are mainly three types of angina. One is stable angina. This stable angina, it is also known as classical angina. Okay, it is also known as exertional angina. Okay, see, these are the different names of first angina. Okay, what happens in stable angina? There is blockage of coronary artery. Suppose this is a coronary artery and these are the endothelial cells. There is some deposition beneath this endothelial cells. Hence the coronary artery becomes narrowed. Okay, this is stable or exertional angina. So in this, the patient has only symptom when the person will do some exercise, because the demand of the heart will increase. The second one we have is unstable angina. In unstable angina, what happens? This atherosclerotic plaque, above which these endothelial cells were there, in unstable angina, these endothelial cells, they become ruptured. Because of this reason, due to endothelial rupture, the platelets, they come and suddenly block this whole coronary artery. They suddenly block the whole coronary artery. Because of endothelial rupture, the platelet comes and block it. Okay, and it is the most dangerous form of angina, because it can lead to complete blockage of artery. Patient will have pain at rest, and it can lead to MI. MI stands for myocardial infarction. And the third type of angina we have is vasospastic angina. Okay, vasospastic angina, which is also known as variant angina. It is also known as Prinz metal angina. Okay, what happens in this case? The coronary artery, there is no blockage, but this coronary artery, it suddenly undergoes into spasm. Okay, hence there will be reduction in blood flow. Now when we talk about the management of angina, we talk about the management of stable and unstable angina. For stable and unstable angina, we give anti-anginal drugs. So anti-anginal drugs, they are mainly given for stable and vasospastic angina. What about unstable angina? Unstable angina is treated like MI. The treatment of unstable angina is like MI. Okay, so when we talk about anti-anginal drug or management of angina, we mainly are concerned with two types of angina. The first is stable angina, And second is visuospastic angina. What about unstable angina? Unstable angina treatment is like MI. Okay, it is treated like MI. So let's talk about now anti-anginal drugs. Okay, so let's make a heading, anti-anginal drugs. Now anti-anginal drugs, they are divided into on the basis of in which condition we are giving. Suppose the patient came to you with acute angina. The patient came to you with acute angina. That patient is having acute chest pain. So there is an attack of angina. We have to treat it. And when we treat this patient, we send the patient back and we prevent the further attacks. That is the treatment of chronic angina. In chronic angina, we prevent further attacks. Now, for acute attack of angina, there is only one drug. The drug of choice for acute attack of angina is nitrates. So during acute attack, we only give one drug, nitrate. Now which nitrate we will write? Either we give sublingual, SL stand for sublingual nitroglycerin, or we give sublingual, or we give sublingual ISDN. ISDN stand for isosorbide dinitrate. These are the only two drugs which are given for acute attack of angina. Rest all other anti-anginal drug, they are given for prevention of angina. They are given in chronic angina. Okay, so for acute attack, the drug of choice is nitrate, and among nitrate we give sublingual nitroglycerin or sublingual isosorbide dinitrate. Now what about chronic angina? In chronic angina, we give the drug to prevent further attacks. Okay, now the drugs in chronic angina, they can be divided into first line drugs, which are mainly started when the patient of angina comes to you, and if it is not controlled, then we add second line drugs. So second line drugs, they are add-on drug. Okay, so second line drugs, they are add-on. Now among first line drug for chronic angina, we will write there are three first line drug. The first drug we will write again is nitrates. So nitrates, they are used both for acute treatment of angina as well as prevention of chronic angina. Second, we will write beta blockers. Third, we will write is calcium channel blockers. Okay, so these are the three first line drugs. Now what about second line drugs? So these are the first line drug. Let's talk about now second line drug. Among second line drug, you will write a mnemonic, N-drift. The first drug is Nicorandil. Then we have Dipyridamol. Then you will write Renolazine. I for Evabredine, F for Fasudil, and T for Trimetazidine. So these are the drugs among angina. Now there are certain recent modification in these drugs. You will write this Dipyridamol now has been banned. We will discuss why it has been banned. It will cause some coronary steel phenomena. And this Renolazine now has become first line drug. It has become now first line drug. Okay, so these are the recent modification. Dipyridamol has been banned. Renolazine now is the first line drug. So before starting with the first drug, remember there are certain new drugs which are in the pipeline. Just remember the name of one drug, oxifedrin. It is a beta 2 agonist. Beta 2 are present on blood vessel, hence it causes coronary artery dilator. So this drug is still under clinical trial. There are high chances that this drug will get approved soon. Okay, so just remember this one additional new information, oxifedrin. So let's start with the first drug, that is nitrates. And we know that nitrates are the only drug which are used in acute as well as chronic angina. So let's make a heading, nitrate. So let's start with the first anti-anginal drug, that is nitrates. Okay. Now what is nitrate? Remember, mechanism of action of nitrate is, nitrate, it is a vasodilator. Okay. Now let's see how it produces vasodilatation and how vasodilatation helps in improvement of angina. Okay. So these nitrates, when we give them to our patient, they go into the smooth muscles of the blood vessels. Okay. It goes to the smooth muscles of blood vessel. Suppose this is a nitrate. It goes into the smooth muscle of the blood vessel. Inside the smooth muscle of blood vessel, there is a certain enzymes. The name of this enzyme is MAD. MAD stands for mitochondrial aldehyde dehydrogenase. Aldehyde dehydrogenase. You will write one more name of one more enzyme, that is GR. GR stands for glutathione reductase. Glutathione reductase. Now what these enzymes will do, these enzyme will separate nitric oxide molecule from these nitrates. Okay. So they will separate nitric oxide. Now what this nitric oxide will do, this nitric oxide stimulate one enzyme which is present in smooth muscle, that is guanyl cyclase. It will stimulate one enzyme, guanyl cyclase. It's a very important point you must remember, that nitric oxide stimulate guanyl cyclase enzyme inside the smooth muscle. Now when this enzyme is stimulated, this guanyl cyclase will very rapidly convert GTP into cyclic GMP. So the level of cyclic GMP will increase. Now this cyclic GMP produces vasodilatation. How it produces vasodilatation? Let's see. It activates or phosphorylate. Activation and phosphorylation means same thing, of one enzyme MLCP, and it inhibit one enzyme or dephosphorylate one enzyme, that is MLCK. Now what does MLCP and MLCK stands for? MLCP stand for myosin light chain phosphatase. P stand for phosphatase. So this enzyme will become active, and MLCK stand for myosin light chain kinase. This enzyme will become inhibited. So what the net effect will be, there will be no phosphate on myosin. There will be no phosphate group will remain on the myosin, because the phosphatase will remove the phosphate group from the myosin and kinase is not working. Because of this reason, myosin will not bind to the actin, because if myosin has to bind to the actin molecule, it needs a phosphate group. So there will be no actin and myosin binding. No myosin and actin binding. If myosin will not bind to actin, the muscles will relax. It will produce vasodilatation. It will produce vasodilatation. Okay. So remember, it stimulate MLCP phosphatase, which will remove the phosphate, and it inhibit kinase, which is usually attaches phosphate to the myosin. Now the point is, a normal physiological mechanism, this cyclic GMP, after some times, it becomes degraded. It becomes degraded by an enzyme known as phosphodiesterase. Phosphodiesterase enzyme. Let's call this enzyme as PDE. So this is the normal functioning. This cyclic GMP action is over by the enzyme phosphodiesterase. Okay. Now let's see, as it has produced vasodilatation, when nitrates have produced vasodilatation, how it is beneficial in angina. Okay. Let's see how it is beneficial in angina. First, we will see how it is beneficial in stable angina. And what is the role of, then we will discuss what is the role of nitrate in vasospastic angina. Okay. Now let's see, due to this vasodilatation, how it useful in stable angina. The main beneficial effect of nitrate in stable angina is due to venodilatation. It produces dilatation of veins. Okay. You know, all the veins, दे टेक दिस ब्लड टू द हार्ट, है ना, फ्रॉम द वेन्स द ब्लड गोज टू द हार्ट. रिमेंबर वीनोडाइलेटेशन वेन्स आर ऑल्सो नोन एज कैपेसिटेंस वेसल, सो यू विल राइट दे डायलेट कैपेसिटेंस वेसल्स, दे डायलेट कैपेसिटेंस वेसल्स. नाउ व्हाट विल हैपन इफ दिस वेसल्स विल बिकम डायलेटेड, इफ दिस वेसल्स विल बिकम डायलेटेड, कैन वी से द ब्लड सप्लाई टू द हार्ट विल डिक्रीज, द ब्लड विल रिमेन डाउनवर्ड्स ओनली, लेस ब्लड विल गो टू द हार्ट. इफ लेस ब्लड विल गो टू द हार्ट एट द एंड ऑफ द डायस्टोल, द वॉल्यूम विच इज कमिंग टू द ब्लड, वॉल्यूम ऑफ द ब्लड विच इज कमिंग टू द हार्ट विल डिक्रीज, सो इट विल रिड्यूस एंड डायस्टोलिक वॉल्यूम, एंड डायस्टोलिक वॉल्यूम. Remember, if end diastolic volume is decreased, now heart has to pump less amount of blood forward. Because of this reason, it decreases systolic duration. It decreases systolic duration. Okay? Now remember, during systole, the coronary arteries, they become crunched or they become collapsed between the muscle cells of the heart. So it will reduce subendocardial coronary crunch. Okay, now because of this reason, there will be equally, if the heart will remain in the systole for less duration of time, the duration of diastole increases, the duration of diastole increases, and during diastole the coronary arteries remain open, they supply the blood to the heart, so it will increase total coronary blood flow. So it will increase total coronary blood flow to the heart. So if the blood supply of the heart is increasing, this beneficial effect will come in stable angina. So there is increase in blood supply to the heart. So that is why they are beneficial in angina, because in angina there is already ischemia or reduction in blood supply. So it started with venodilatation. Remember, everything started with due to venodilatation. So their main mechanism is venodilatation in stable angina. Now what about unstable angina? In unstable angina, nitrates, they can directly dilate coronary arteries. They can directly dilate coronary arteries, because in vasospastic angina the coronary arteries were collapsed. Now why they are directly dilating coronary artery? Because of endothelial independent. Earlier endothelial cell were dependent for coronary artery dilatation, but now not. Remember, endothelial independent nitric oxide production by nitrates. Normally our endothelial cell also produces nitric oxide which dilates coronary artery, but in case of nitrate, instead of endothelial cell, these nitrate will directly give their nitric oxide and they themselves can directly dilate coronary artery without the help of endothelial cells. Okay, so that is why they are beneficial in vasospastic angina. Okay, that is why they are beneficial in vasospastic angina. Okay, now let's talk about one drug interaction of nitrate. Let's talk about here only because we have seen their mechanism of action. My question is, we have seen that these nitrates, they form nitric oxide and nitric oxide increases cyclic GMP. We have one class of drug that are known as phosphodiesterase inhibitors. If we inhibit phosphodiesterase enzyme, don't you think it will also increase the level of cyclic GMP? So there is a class of a drug known as phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors. PDE stand for phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor. The name of these drugs are sildenafil, tadalafil, which we have already discussed, they were used in the treatment of impotency mainly. Okay, now these phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor, their main mechanism of action is to increase cyclic GMP. Okay, and these drugs should never be combined with nitrates. Why? Because nitrates, they also increase the production of cyclic GMP. Because of very large production of cyclic GMP, when we combine nitrates with phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor like sildenafil and tadalafil, it leads to massive vasodilatation. Which will lead to sudden hypotension and it leads to sudden death. Because of massive hypotension, it will lead to sudden death. Hence, remember, never combine nitrates with phosphodiesterase inhibitors, or never combine phosphodiesterase inhibitors with nitrate. It will lead to massive vasodilatation, okay, and it will lead to sudden death. So this interaction you must remember. Now let's talk about the drugs we have among nitrates. Let's see the various drugs we have among nitrates. Okay. So before writing the names of these drugs, remember all these nitrates, they are organic compounds. That is why they are known as organic nitrates. And they are highly lipid soluble drug. Remember, lipid soluble drugs are also known as non-ionic drugs. So they are highly lipid soluble or highly ionic drugs. So keeping this thing in mind, let's see what are the various nitrate drugs we have. The first drug we will write is nitroglycerin. Okay. Second we will write is isosorbide. Dinitrate, in short form you can write ISDN. Okay, then we will write its active form. It goes into the body and get converted into active form. We have made it that active form as a drug as well. You'll write its active form is isosorbide mononitrate. Okay, let's call it as ISMN. Okay, now we will write certain other drugs like erythritol, tetranitrate, and lastly you will write penta erythritol. Again, tetranitrate. Okay. Now let's see first what is their route. What are their route of administration? How we give to our patient? Okay. Now all of these drugs are given orally. Okay. All of these drugs are given orally. And the first two drugs, nitroglycerin, can be given sublingually. Sublingually as a tablet, which is placed sublingually, or as a spray, sublingual spray. Similarly, isosorbide is also given sublingually as a tablet. While all other drugs will not have any other route. Okay. Now, apart from this, nitroglycerin can be given. Nitroglycerin, it can be given, you will write, it can be given by transdermal route as well, as a transdermal patch. Okay. And it can be given intravenously, IV. These are the some other routes of nitroglycerin. So nitroglycerin can be given by many routes. While other drugs, they are given just by certain few routes. Okay. Now there is one route in which we never give nitroglycerin. We never give nitroglycerin intramuscularly. Okay. We never give nitroglycerin intramuscularly because intramuscular injection of a highly lipid soluble drug is very painful. It's highly painful injection. We never give intramuscular injection of nitroglycerin. So this route is never given. So it's a commonly asked question. So in nitroglycerin, you will not give by intramuscular route. Okay. Now the first question is, sir, why we are giving these drugs by sublingual route or transdermal route? The reason is sublingual or transdermal route, they avoid first pass metabolism of liver. They avoid first pass metabolism of liver. So all these nitrates, they have very high first pass metabolism in liver. Okay. So all these nitrates, they have very high first pass metabolism in liver, except isosorbide dinitrate, mononitrate. Isosorbide mononitrate does not have, this is the exception among all nitrate, it does not undergo first pass metabolism in liver. First pass metabolism in liver. Among all nitrate, it is the only nitrate which does not have any first pass metabolism in liver. So now the point is, it's a highly lipid soluble drug, so it will get very rapidly absorbed and it will not get degraded in the liver. Because of these two property of isosorbide mononitrate, it's a drug, isosorbide mononitrate, which has 100% oral bioavailability. It's a drug which 100% oral bioavailability. Okay, because of two reasons, it is highly lipid soluble drug and it does not undergo any degradation or metabolism in the liver. So it is the only nitrate which have no metabolism in the liver. Now let's talk about certain properties. We will write this pentaerythritol tetranitrate, the longest name, it is the longest nitrate. It is the longest nitrate. Which of the following is the shortest acting nitrate? Shortest acting, you will write, shortest acting nitrate is inhalational amyl nitrite. But this inhalational amyl nitrite nowadays is not used for angina. Okay, but overall it is the shortest acting. But nowadays the drug which we are using for the treatment of angina, among them the shortest acting is sublingual nitroglycerin. Okay, so among them the shortest acting is sublingual nitroglycerin. Remember, nitroglycerin is also known as glyceryl trinitrate. It is also known as glyceryl trinitrate. So overall, if somebody will ask you, the overall shortest acting nitrate is inhalational amyl nitrite. But nowadays we don't use in angina. In angina, which we use drug is sublingual nitroglycerin. Okay. Now the next point is, nitrate, they show tolerance. So we'll write a heading, nitrate tolerance. Now what do we mean by the word nitrate tolerance? Nitrate tolerance means, if you will give these nitrates continuously, this continuous administration of nitrate, they will show very rapid loss of effect. If you will give these nitrates continuously to your patient, they will have very rapid loss of effect. Their effect will be lost. Why it occurs? Because of downregulation. Because of downregulation of MAD enzyme and GR enzyme. What does it mean? It means, if you will continuously give nitrate, these MAD enzyme, mitochondrial aldehyde dehydrogenase and glutathione reductase enzyme, they will stop functioning. Okay, they will stop functioning. That means, if you will give nitrate continuously, this enzyme will stop functioning. If this enzyme will stop functioning, what will happen? They will not able to liberate nitric oxide. Because of this reason, nitrate, they will not produce any effect. Okay, so nitrate, they show tolerance. Now a question arises, which route of nitrate shows maximum tolerance? Maximum tolerance is shown by the route in which the nitrates are going continuously into the body. Maximum tolerance is seen by transdermal patches. Okay, and minimum is seen by, which will go for into the body for certain shortest duration of time, minimum tolerance or no tolerance is seen with sublingual nitroglycerin. NTG stands for nitroglycerin. So Why transdermal patch? Because transdermal patch, the nitrate is continuously delivered into the body. If continuously delivered, these MAD and GR enzyme will become tired and they will stop functioning. Okay. Now, what is the best method of avoiding nitrate tolerance? How to avoid it? How to avoid nitrate tolerance? The best method of avoiding nitrate tolerance is to give nitrate free interval. To give nitrate free interval of 8 hours. Okay, of 8 hours. Now we give this nitrate free interval, we will remove nitrate, we will tell the patient not to have this transdermal patch for 8 hours during bedtime or night time, because during night time or sleeping the patient heart oxygen demand is minimal. Okay, so we will tell the patient that before going to the bed, remove this transdermal patch, and when the patient will wake up next day, that patient will again put that transdermal patch along, because within this 8 hours these enzymes will become replenished. These enzymes will become replenished and they are again ready to work. Okay, so after 8 hours these enzyme will become replenished if we will withdraw nitrate for 8 hours. There is a new nitrate which does not show tolerance. That new nitrate which does not show tolerance is, you will write molsidomine. Molsidomine is a new nitrate. It's a nitrate with no tolerance. It does not depend upon this enzyme. Okay? Nitrate with no tolerance. Okay? Now let's see what are the uses of nitrates. Uses. The first use of nitrate is angina, that we know. Now in which angina, we will write, they are used in both stable as well as vasospastic angina, and we have discussed their different mechanism of action, and they are used for both acute attack of angina and prevention of chronic angina. So in chronic angina we give generally transdermal patches. Okay, so it is given in both type of angina and both forms of angina. Second, it is also used in the treatment of MI. MI is myocardial infarction. In myocardial infarction we give slow IV infusion of nitroglycerin. Nitroglycerin is NTG. Okay, slow IV infusion of nitroglycerin, and it should be given by very precaution. Remember, during MI, if the BP of the patient is less than 90 millimeter of mercury and the heart rate is either less than 50 or more than 100 beats per minute, then this nitroglycerin is absolutely contraindicated. We don't give in MI. Okay, so please, before giving nitroglycerin in MI, ensure the blood pressure is more than 90 and the heart rate is between 50 to 100. Okay, otherwise it will have poor outcomes. Third point you will write, they are also used in acute pulmonary edema. They're also used in acute pulmonary edema or acute pulmonary edema is seen in acute left ventricular failure. Okay, acute left ventricular failure. Now what is the treatment of acute ventricular failure? Remember, the drug of choice for acute pulmonary edema is loop diuretics. Loop diuretics like furosemide, because they act as a venodilator. If it is not controlled, we add morphine, because it is also a venodilator. If it is not controlled, then we give IV nitroglycerin. This is the treatment of acute pulmonary edema. These drugs we use for the treatment of acute pulmonary edema, but the drug of choice is loop diuretic. Not controlled, add morphine. Not controlled, add nitroglycerin. Okay, let's move forward. Let's see the second use. The next use of nitrate is, nitrate is also given in cases of colicky pain is also known as spasmodic pain, because it relaxes smooth muscles, so it is a beneficial in cases of spasmodic pain. Now, which spasmodic pain? You will write it is given in cases of biliary colic. Okay, when the gallbladder undergoes into spasm, and second is esophageal spasm. Okay, esophageal colic. But remember, these nitrate, they are ineffective. They are not effective in renal colic because they cannot dilate renal smooth muscles. They are not effective in renal colic. So they are only given in biliary and esophageal colic, not in renal colic. And the last use of these nitrate are, they are used for the treatment of cyanide poisoning. They are also used for the treatment of cyanide poisoning. Now, instead of nitrate, nowadays we are using for the drug of choice for cyanide poisoning now have become rather nitrites. Nitrites, why? Because nitrites, they are even faster acting drug as compared to nitrate. Okay, so which nitrite we give? We give inhalational amyl nitrite. It is the drug of choice for cyanide poisoning. Or we give intravenous, we combine with intravenous sodium nitrite. We combine with sodium nitrite. Okay. Okay. Now, what is the mechanism of action of nitrate or nitrite? Both have same mechanism of action. These drug, what they will do? These drug, they convert hemoglobin, which is present in the blood, by donating their nitric oxide. Nitric oxide will convert hemoglobin into methemoglobin. So this nitric oxide oxidizes hemoglobin into methemoglobin, and this methemoglobin chelates cyanide. It binds with the circulating cyanide. It chelates with the cyanide. So when cyanide will come, this methemoglobin will bind to this cyanide and it will render ineffective. It will get converted into cyanomethemoglobin. So they are indirectly acting drugs. They are creating a chelator. They are producing a chelator for cyanide inside our body. Okay. So this cyanomethemoglobin created by nitrates or nitrite, it can be removed out of the body. Now we give sodium thiosulfate. This can be removed. How it can be removed? Very easily. Sodium thiosulfate we give, and sodium thiosulfate will convert cyanomethemoglobin into sodium thiocyanate, and this sodium thiocyanate can be removed in urine or through hemodialysis. Okay, so these nitrate, they are the drug of choice for cyanide poisoning, but remember, they are indirectly acting drugs. Okay, how they are indirectly? They convert hemoglobin into methemoglobin, which act as a chelator. Now we have one directly acting drug as well, which is even combined with them. One directly acting drug for cyanide poisoning is hydroxycobalamin. Hydroxycobalamin. Now, hydroxycobalamin is a vitamin, that is B12, vitamin B12. Now, it contains one metal, that is cobalt. Now, this cobalt in hydroxycobalamin act as a chelator. Now, what this will do, this cobalt will convert, will chelate with cyanide. It will be converted into cyanocobalamin. So it's a directly acting drug. While nitrates, they were indirectly acting drugs. Okay. So it will convert cyanide into cyanocobalamin. And this cyanocobalamin can be excreted just like sodium thiocyanate. It will be converted into, we will add sodium thiosulfate also, and it will also form sodium thiocyanate, which can be removed out of the body. So this is the role of nitrate and nitrites in cyanide poisoning. So nowadays we have a nitrite kit. We have a nitrite kit. And that nitrite kit contains amyl nitrite, sodium nitrite, hydroxycobalamin. It contains these substances. So we have a nitrite kit for the treatment of cyanide poisoning. Okay. Now let's see what are the side effects of nitrates. Nitrate, we know they are vasodilators, and vasodilators, they have certain common side effect. If there is vessel dilatation in skin, it leads to flushing. If the blood vessels of cerebral artery dilate, it causes pulsatile headache. Okay, if the veins of the legs they dilate, it leads to postural hypotension. And sudden vasodilatation or hypotension leads to reflex tachycardia. So these are the common side effects of all vasodilators, which is seen with nitrates as well. Okay, additionally, it also increases intraocular tension and intracranial tension. Okay, it increases IOT, intraocular tension and intracranial tension. So this is all about nitrates. Now let's talk about other anti-anginal drugs. Other anti-anginal drug, the first one, first line drug is beta blockers. We will write what is their mechanism of action. These beta blocker on heart, we know we have beta 1 receptor, and beta 1 receptor normally stimulates heart. So these beta blocker, what is their mechanism of action? They inhibit beta 1 receptor on heart. Because of this reason, they decrease heart rate. Okay, can we say they will prevent tachycardia? Because of this reason, they will decrease myocardial oxygen demand. Because if the heart does not have to function much, its oxygen and nutritional requirement will decrease. Okay, because of this reason, it decreases myocardial oxygen demand. It becomes the drug of choice for, not for acute, chronic angina. And which angina? You will write chronic stable angina. Beta blockers, they are the drug of choice for chronic stable angina. Why? Because they are the most effective drug. Okay, now what about drugs which we use? Remember, before going further, these beta blockers, they are absolutely contraindicated in vasospastic angina. Because of beta 2. If they will block beta 2 receptor, beta 2 were present on blood vessel. If we will block beta 2 receptor, it produces vasoconstriction. Due to coronary vasoconstriction, they will precipitate, they will increase the chances of vasospastic angina. Okay? So they are the drug of choice for chronic stable angina, but they are absolutely contraindicated in vasospastic angina. Okay, let's see what are the beta blockers we have. We have two classes of beta blocker. One we have is non-selective beta blocker. Non-selective beta blocker means they will block beta 1 as well as beta 2 equally. They block both of them equally. Then we have cardioselective beta blocker. Cardioselective beta blocker will block beta 1, very less of beta 2. Okay, because of this reason, as you are seeing, we need the action on beta 1 mainly. We don't want the action on beta 2. There is a non-selective beta blocker, propranolol. Well, right, propranolol nowadays is never used for the treatment of angina. Because of beta 2 mediated action, it very commonly precipitates vasospastic angina. We need action on beta 2, hence we nowadays use cardioselective beta blocker, because they have less chance of precipitating vasospastic angina. The drugs you can write is metoprolol, atenolol. So these are the drugs which we very commonly use. Okay, now the third class of drug we have is calcium channel blockers. Okay, now calcium channel blockers, we are having, what is their mechanism of action? These calcium channel blockers, they block L type of voltage gated calcium channel. And these L type of voltage gated calcium channel, they are present on smooth muscles. They are present on muscles. So if in muscle, the muscle calcium will not go, this muscle will become relaxed. Okay, now let's see what are the drugs we have among calcium channel blockers. Among calcium channel blocker, we have two kinds of drug. One is DHP type of calcium channel blocker. Okay, they all end with the word dipine. And we have non-DHP. Okay, now what about DHP type? DHP type of calcium channel blocker, they are direct coronary artery dilator. They are direct coronary artery dilator. They dilate coronary artery directly. Because of this reason, they are the drug of choice for vasospastic angina. They are the drug of choice for vasospastic angina. Okay, now examples we will be seeing with this drug example shortly. Now let's talk about non-DHP. Non-DHP, we have a drug verapamil. Now verapamil and diltiazem. Now verapamil blocks calcium channel on heart. Because of this reason, it mainly have action on heart, and DHP type, they have action on blood vessels. So because of this reason, if we inhibit calcium channel on heart, it suppresses heart. It suppresses heart. So heart have to function less. Because of this reason, it will decrease the oxygen demand of the heart. Because of this reason, this verapamil can be used in chronic stable angina. But we discussed for chronic stable angina, the drug of choice was beta blockers. So you remember, verapamil is used as a replacement of beta blocker. If beta blockers are contraindicated, then we give verapamil. Okay? Okay? But remember, never combine this beta blocker with verapamil, because it will lead to marked cardiosuppression. Never combine beta blockers with verapamil. And the second drug I am writing is diltiazem also, because this diltiazem has both action. This diltiazem is a coronary artery dilator, and this diltiazem is also suppressing heart. So this diltiazem is the most preferred drug among calcium channel blocker, because it has dual action. It dilates blood vessel also, coronary artery also, and it directly suppresses heart. So generally for chronic stable angina, we use beta blocker. These drug can be used as a replacement, never combined. Now what about DHP type? In DHP type, which drug we will use? All these drug, they end with the word dipine. You will write, we use long acting drugs like amlodipine, phelodipine, very important, nitrendipine. Okay, but remember, one DHP type of calcium channel blocker, coronary artery dilator, is absolutely contraindicated, that is nifedipine. We never give nifedipine. Why? Because this nifedipine is a very short acting drug. It's a very short acting drug. It produces sudden artery dilatation. It produces sudden artery dilatation, and sudden artery dilatation leads to reflex tachycardia. If the blood vessels in the whole body suddenly dilates, it leads to reflex tachycardia, and this reflex tachycardia precipitates or increase the chances of angina, because the oxygen and nutritional demand of the heart will increase, which can lead to MI also. Okay, so we never give nifedipine because it produces reflex tachycardia. Reflex tachycardia increases oxygen demand. So among calcium channel blocker, remember, we never give nifedipine. Okay, so this is about the first line drug. Let's talk about now second line drugs for angina. Okay, So the mnemonic was end drift. Let's see what are the drugs we have. The first was Nicorandil. What is the mechanism of action of Nicorandil? Nicorandil is a potassium channel opener. Because of this reason, it is a coronary dilator. It is also an NO donor. Due to this, it's a coronary artery dilator. Plus, it also tells the heart to get survived in low ischemic area. It produces ischemic preconditioning. Nicorandil produces ischemic preconditioning. It makes heart cells resistant to ischemia. It makes heart resistant to ischemia. So where it is used, Nicorandil is used as an add-on drug in resistant angina. Resistant angina means angina not controlled by first line drug. Not controlled by first line drug. Then we use as an add-on drug Nicorandil. Okay, so it is used as an add-on drug if the angina is not controlled by all these three first line agent. What is the side effect? Nicorandil causes aphthous ulcers. It causes aphthous ulcers. So this was the first drug, Nicorandil. Let's talk about other drug. The second drug we will write is dipyridamole. Dipyridamole. Now let's see what is the mechanism of action of dipyridamole. Dipyridamole, it causes adenosine efflux from endothelial cell. Suppose this is an endothelial cell, it removes adenosine efflux. Because of this reason, this adenosine act as a very powerful coronary artery dilator. It acts as a coronary artery dilator. Now, if this adenosine is acting as a coronary dilator, now what will happen? Ideally, we believe that if the coronary artery is dilating, it's a good thing, okay? But the problem with dipyridamole is it dilates coronary artery in non-ischemic area. It dilates coronary artery in non-ischemic area. Because of this reason, the blood which was going from ischemic area will get diverted into non-ischemic area. This is known as coronary Steel syndrome. Coronary Steel syndrome. Okay? So it causes coronary Steel syndrome. Because of this reason, it was rather precipitating angina. It was increasing angina. Although it is a coronary artery dilator, but it increases angina. Hence it got banned. But till now, this dipyridamole, it is used in stroke patient. It is not used in MI or angina. It is used in stroke patient. Remember, it has one more additional mechanism of action. It's a phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor. Because of this reason, it has antiplatelet effect also. Because of this reason, it is sometimes used in stroke patient as well. That we will be discussing in blood chapter. Okay. Now, can we say we need a coronary artery dilator? So it's a good thing. But it was dilating in wrong area. So that is why dipyridamole is sometimes known as, it is producing action correctly, but at a wrong place. So it is a pharmacological success. But it is dilating in a wrong place. It is a therapeutic failure. Therapeutic failure means no beneficial effect is produced. So dipyridamole is an example of pharmacological success, but with therapeutic failure. Okay. Now let's understand, what do we mean by this coronary Steel syndrome? What do we mean by it is dilating coronary artery in non-ischemic area? So suppose this is the muscle of the heart. These are the muscles of the heart which needs oxygen. And on the surface of heart, you know coronary arteries they run. Suppose these are the coronary artery on the surface of heart. Okay. Now these coronary artery, they give 90 degree branches into the muscles. These coronary artery, they give 90 degree branches into the muscle. So the coronary artery, which is on the surface of the heart, this coronary artery is known as epicardial coronary artery. Epicardial. Epi means surface, on the surface. Epicardial coronary artery, they are also known as large conducting vessel. Large conducting coronary artery. Okay. And these small coronary artery, which are penetrating into the muscles, they are known as subendocardial, because they are inside the muscle. Subendocardial coronary arteries, they are also known as autoregulatory coronary arteries. Okay, they are also known as autoregulatory coronary artery. Now what happens, suppose the blood is coming from this coronary artery and this blood normally divides. Suppose due to atherosclerosis, there is some blockage of coronary artery. Let's say this A, B and C, these are the three coronary artery. Due to some blockage, the blood supply to this myocardial area decreases. This is an ischemic area. Now, ideally, in cases of angina, we should increase the blood supply in this ischemic area. We should dilate this artery. Now, let's see what dipyridamole does. Dipyridamole dilates these subendocardial autoregulatory coronary artery in non-ischemic area. That means this dipyridamole dilates A and B. Because of this reason, what happens? Whatever the blood was coming to the coronary artery totally gets diverted into subendocardial region, which are non-ischemic. So the blood which is coming to this ischemic green area will become very less, because it dilates which part? It dilates these arteries. Dipyridamole dilates these arteries. So the blood will go into them, which is in non-ischemic area. Now, because of this reason, the blood which was coming to ischemic area will be chilled by these non-ischemic area. This is known as coronary chill phenomena. So this is caused by dipyridamole. So dipyridamole dilates subendocardial or autoregulatory coronary arteries in non-ischemic area. But we have a drug, nitrates. Nitrates are also coronary artery dilator. Remember, nitrates, they dilate epicardial coronary arteries. If it will dilate epicardial coronary artery, can we say that the total amount of the blood which is coming into this coronary artery will increase? It increases total coronary blood flow. So it will, more blood will go to the non-ischemic area and more blood will go to the ischemic area as well. So nitrate, they dilate epicardial or large coronary arteries. Because of this reason, the total coronary blood flow increases. Total coronary blood flow increases. Okay, which is a good thing. While dipyridamole only dilate these arteries, which are non-ischemic area, subendocardial, they do not increase total coronary blood flow. Okay, so nitrate, hence they are beneficial. Dipyridamole has been banned because of this coronary chill phenomena. Okay, now let's move further. The next drug we have is ranolazine. Ranolazine, its mechanism of action, we will write, its main mechanism of action is it inhibits late sodium channels on heart. Okay, it has a minor mechanism of action which is insignificant. It has one minor mechanism of action. That minor mechanism of action, you will write, this dipyranolazine is also a PFOX inhibitor. Now, what is this PFOX inhibitor? We will discuss later on, okay, shortly with another drug. So, the main mechanism of action of renolazine is it inhibits late sodium channel. Now, we know that sodium channels on heart is needed for depolarization of muscles. Only then muscles will contract. Because of this reason, the muscles will not contract. As the muscles will not contract, it will directly decrease the demand of oxygen for myocardial. So it will decrease myocardial oxygen demand. Because of this reason, it is used in chronic stable angina. Okay, chronic stable angina. And now renolazine has become first line drug. Earlier it was a second line drug. It has now become the drug of choice for chronic stable angina. Okay, it has one more advantage. We will write this renolazine has one advantage. It also reduces HbA1c level. HbA1c means blood glucose level. And it is also reduces bad lipid levels. It also reduces bad lipid level. Because of this reason, it is a very good drug for diabetic patient, diabetes mellitus patient, and dyslipidemia patient. And diabetes and dyslipidemia causes atherosclerosis or coronary artery blockage. Okay, now what is the side effect? It causes QT prolongation. Why it causes QT prolongation on heart? Because of blockage of potassium channel on heart. It also blocks potassium channel on heart, which produces a side effect, QT prolongation. So this is the side effect of renolazine. Okay, the beneficial effect is due to blockage of sodium channel. Okay, now let's talk about the next drug, that is evabradine. Now, what is the mechanism of action of evabradine in angina? You will write evabradine, it inhibit funny channels on SA node. It inhibit funny channels on SA node. Now what is funny channel? You will write funny channel is also known as inward sodium potassium current. We write it as INA potassium current. It is also known as IF current, that means funny current. It is also known as pacemaker potential. It is also known as pacemaker potential. Now, because of these funny channels, this SA node remains partially depolarized, and this SA node is the main cell in the heart which maintains the heart rate. Okay, that is why SA node is known as pacemaker, because it is the first cell in our heart to get depolarized, and due to its depolarization, all the heart cells will follow the depolarization due to SA node. It decides the heart rate. So when we inhibit this funny channels, because of this funny channel, SA node is the first cell to get depolarized. If we inhibit this funny channel, SA node becomes inhibited. Because of this reason, evabradine is a pure, it decreases heart rate. It decreases heart rate because it inhibits SA node. And you will write it's a pure heart rate lowering drug. It's a pure heart rate lowering drug because it is inhibiting SA node, some channels on SA node. Okay. Now, let's see what are the uses of evabradine. We know evabradine is used in as a second line drug in chronic stable angina, because if the heart will not beat more, the oxygen and nutritional requirement of heart will decrease. And recently evabradine is also been approved for CHF, heart failure. Okay, heart failure. Now what are the side effect? The side effect of evabradine is very logical. It causes bradycardia. Okay, and it also causes visual disturbance. Now, which visual disturbance? We will write it causes luminous phenomena. Luminous phenomena means the normal light will appear very bright. It will appear very luminous or very bright. Why? Because of Because these funny channels, they are also present on retina. Retina also have these kind of funny channel. If evobridine inhibit this funny channel on retina, which causes some visual disturbances known as luminous phenomena. Okay? Because of funny channels are present on retina. Okay? Let's move forward. The next drug, the second last drug we have is Fasudil. Fasudil, we will write, it's a ROCK inhibitor. Mechanism of action? It's a ROCK inhibitor. ROCK stand for Rho kinase. ROCK stand for Rho kinase inhibitor. Now this Rho kinase enzyme is needed for vasoconstriction. If we inhibit this Rho kinase enzyme, remember it's a coronary artery dilator. Okay, it's a coronary artery dilator. So it's a vasodilator. Because of this reason, this Fasudil is being approved for a drug for a disease known as vasospastic angina. It's an approved drug for vasospastic angina. And nowadays, it has some potential use. Potentially, it can be used for, although it is not approved, potentially it will be used in subarachnoid hemorrhage. Why subarachnoid hemorrhage? To treat cerebral vasospasm. It's an artery dilator to treat cerebral vasospasm, which is seen in subarachnoid hemorrhage. We give it has also been very shortly, right now it is not approved, it will also be approved in pulmonary artery hypertension. It has also been tried in pulmonary artery hypertension, but right now it has been approved in vasospastic angina as a coronary artery dilator. It also dilates cerebral arteries and pulmonary arteries as well. Okay, now the last drug we will discuss is trimetazidine. The last drug we have is trimetazidine. Now, what is the mechanism of action of trimetazidine? We will write trimetazidine inhibit PFOX. It's a PFOX inhibitor. Now, what does PFOX stand for? PFOX stand for partial fatty acid oxidation. That means it inhibit the metabolism or oxidation of fatty acid in the body. Okay, so fats will not be oxidized. Now by inhibiting which enzyme it inhibit fatty acid oxidation? It inhibit LC3 cat enzyme. LC3 cat enzyme, also known as thiolase enzyme. So it inhibit one enzyme needed for fatty acid oxidation. Because of this reason, the fats will not get oxidized. It also has antioxidant property. Now, what is the benefit of inhibiting fat oxidation in angina patient? Now we know that fats in our body, when in the presence of oxygen they get oxidized, they form ATP. Okay, and we know one more source of energy in our body is glucose. Glucose also in presence of oxygen they get oxidized and they form ATP. Now the question is, sir, which requires more oxygen to form ATP? Remember, fats, they require more oxygen. Glucose, they require very less oxygen to form ATP or to form energy. Now what trimetazidine has done? Trimetazidine has inhibit this fatty acid oxidation. So what the heart will try to do? The heart will shift the metabolism from fat to carbohydrate. Heart will shift the energy requirement or metabolism from fat to glucose or carbohydrate. Now we know it's a good thing. Why? Because now ATP can be formed in less oxygen environment. So already in angina the blood supply was less. So now ATP can be obtained in low oxygen. So it's a good thing in angina, because now already the oxygen supply was less. If the heart will shift the metabolism from fat to carbohydrate, energy can be obtained in low oxygen concentration. Okay, so it's a drug which shifts the metabolism of heart from fat to glucose. Okay, by inhibiting fatty acid oxidation. So let's see where it is used. This drug is an approved drug for chronic stable angina. It's an approved drug for chronic stable angina. Recently, it has been approved for treatment of tinnitus. Trimetazidine has been approved for the treatment of tinnitus, which is seen in a disease known as Meniere's disease. Okay, Meniere's disease. So these are the two uses of trimetazidine, and the side effect of trimetazidine is it causes Parkinson's disease because it degrades dopamine in the brain by interfering with some enzymes, MAO enzymes. That is why. So side effect is Parkinson's disease. So this is about trimetazidine. It's a PFOX inhibitor, and this completes our all anti-anginal drugs. So thank you very much for listening.